The drama of the week is a download from the BBC.
I'm on the right track for lots of kissing, so that old greenback I won't be missing. All the greatest things in life are free. Who needs money? Not me.
I think I might start doing Botox, Cheryl.
Oh, that's a good idea, Bet. You are going a bit wrinkly.
Not for me. I'm going to offer it as a new treatment. We can't go on just doing hairdressing.
I like doing hairdressing.
I'm wasted here. I never get to use the full gamut of my skills and abilities. It's like Michelangelo turning up to paint the 16th chapel and being told he's got to clean the toilets.
Are you broke again, Bev?
I have a short-term liquidity problem.
Graham suffers with that. Do your ankles swell up?
No. I need to diversificate, Cheryl.
Do you? Well, can I do the Botox with you?
No, I'd like you to get involved, Cheryl, but they won't allow any old clodhopper to administer a dangerous drug.
Don't needles make you feel queasy, Bev?
I'm not going to use a needle, Cheryl. I'm going to spray it on.
I can do that.
You have to be medically trained.
Well, you're not.
I did my brownie first aid badge.
I thought they wouldn't let you in.
I did it online, and I've watched every episode of Embarrassing Bodies.
My Graham applied to be on that.
All right, with his ears?
No, with his feet.
I'm not wrinkly, Cheryl.
Oh, you are a bit. What's the matter with my husband's ears?
Not if you like African elephants. Where have I got wrinkles?
Well, your forehead's quite creased.
Only when I frown.
And you've got little crow's feet around your eyes and your mouth.
They're laughter lines, Cheryl.
Are they?
I'm a fun person. I'm always laughing.
I've never seen you. Well, apart from when Nigel got run over by Beryl Birkinshaw's mobility scooter.
It's subterranean with me, Cheryl. I laugh inside.
I like Graham's ears. I think they're one of his best features.
You're all right if you want to hear Russian spy planes from 400 miles. Have you mopped the floor yet?
Oh, this mop's had it. I think we need a new one.
Do I look like I'm made of money?
I'm spreading more hairs than I'm picking up.
You're not doing it right, Cheryl.
Oh, hello, Mr. Butts.
Hello, lady. I must apologise for my tardiness.
Good punctuation means not being late, Mr. Butts.
In pursuance of my duties delivering Her Majesty's post, I was savaged by a wild beast.
Where?
Up the Twitchell.
Oh, was it that Doberman in the bungalow?
No, it was the sausage dog next door. It went for my throat.
Did it have a stepladder?
You might have to have a tetanitis injection.
So, what is it, Mr. Butt? The usual, a trim?
Yes, thank you. But before you begin your tonsorial artistry, may I crave your indulgence?
I haven't cleaned it yet.
What?
The toilet.
No, no. Might I prevail upon you to put this road closure notice in votra funitra?
You what?
Can you stick this in your window?
No, I'm afraid not, Mr. Butts.
It's for the Bridgeford Trot on Friday, Beverly. The whole village is taking part.
Well, I'm not.
Everyone loves a fun run.
Anyone who thinks that running 5 miles is fun wants their head examining.
I'm doing it. I was going to ask you to sponsor me, Bev.
Well, think again.
It's for charity.
I've been doing good works all my life, Cheryl, and nobody's ever given me any charity. Anyway, who's going to sponsor you?
Lots of people. I've already collected 500. I've got it in my purse, look. I'm going to jog down to the bank at lunchtime.
£500? Who are you collecting for?
The donkey sanctuary.
What's a donkey need that much money for?
Carrots.
For £500 worth? That's a lorry load.
I'm sorry you feel so disengaged, Beverly. I was hoping to persuade you to take part in my relay team.
Bev's never been very sporty, have you?
I have. I was quite an athlete in my younger years.
I never knew that.
I would have won the Commonwealth Games if it hadn't been for my crucial ligament.
Really? I had no idea. What was your event, Beverly?
The 4,000 metres.
Don't you mean 5,000?
I know, they cut it short that year because of the Russian boycott.
Russia's not in the Commonwealth.
They're in the Eurovision Song Contest.
Are they?
So's Australia.
Oh, Beverly, maybe you could help Cheryl with her training if you've competed at such a high level.
Then I haven't got time for that. I've got a business to run.
Graham's in charge of my training.
What does he know about sport?
He's secretary of the darts team.
Exactly.
He's very strict. He says I've got to walk at least 5 miles a day. He gave me a barometer to wear on my wrist. It's linked to his phone.
What for?
Well, so we can see how far I'm walking when he's at work.
Let's have a look at it then, Cheryl.
I'm not wearing it. It's on Curly's collar.
What? So your dog walks the 5 miles, not you?
You won't tell Graham, will you, Bev?
Well, that won't, Cheryl. But if Curly goes after a rabbit and does 17 miles, don't come running to me.
Ladies, I do have a rather pressing engagement. Do you think we could expedite matters, please?
I'm not sure.
Well, you should have said it if you're in a hurry.
My sincere apologies, Beverly. Just do what you can in 5 minutes, please.
I'm not a sheep shearer, Mr. Butt. I'm an artiste. I've worked with the best. Ooh. I've never heard anyone tell Siegfried Sassoon to hurry up and see what he could do in 5 minutes.
Perhaps I should come back later?
No. Beauty station number one, please. Sit down. Oh. Cheryl, damp the dandruff down, will you?
I haven't got dandruff, Beverly.
No, of course you haven't. It's just a genial term we use for all dry skin inflictions, isn't it, Shirl?
Is it?
So what is this urgent, pressing engagement?
Oh, I'm doing a favour for my brother-in-law.
Oh, I didn't think you got on with Daz.
Oh, I don't. It wasn't my idea.
But Mrs. Butt insisted.
I have got a mind of my own, Beverly.
Of course you have. So what did she tell you to do?
Move some gym equipment from Bingthorpe caravan site.
The one that burnt down in superstitious circumstances?
Yes. Daz was the caretaker.
Didn't take very good care of it then, did he?
No. And I'm the one stuck with half a ton of smoke-damaged equipment in the back of my camper van. He wants me to sell it on eBay for him.
Is it badly damaged?
It's covered in soot.
Why can't he sell it?
That's what I said.
But Mrs. Butt put her foot down.
I told her I hadn't got time for all that. I'm the chair of the organising committee and the race marshal for the fun run.
Well, your wife has never been a big one for having fun, has she?
No, not really.
How much does Daz want for it, then?
He thinks it's worth a grand or more.
Fat chance. Is it even his to sell?
I don't know. All I want to do is get on with my duties. I've got to set up the water stations, collect the bibs and find a sponsor for the trophies.
Do you think our Tony could be a race marshal? He loves badges.
I'm not sure your son's got the right attributes, Shirl.
What do you need?
Common sense and the ability to tie your own shoelaces.
I'm sure Tony has a lot of good points, but marshalling requires a particular type of personality.
Like what?
Boring, self-important jobs with. Shirl, pass me the electric clippers.
Here you go, Bev.
I'll just tidy up your neck, Mr. Butt.
The annual village fun run wouldn't happen if it weren't for people like me, Beverly.
Good. Ooh. Oh, lean forward.
Everyone's talking about it, Bev. The whole village has gone fitness mad.
I'm not surprised. There's an epidemic of morbid obesity in Bridgeford. Keeping yourself trim is about self-discipline and diet. Did you get those hobnobs, Shirl?
Yes, they're on the top shelf. I better not have any. I'm in training. Well, one won't hurt. Maybe two. I'll put the kettle on.
No, leave it, Shirl. You can have your tea break during your lunch break.
Well, you've got over 100 people taking part, Beverly.
It's just a fad.
A lot of people are taking it very seriously, Bev. Lois Heber Ferdinand has had her own personal trainer.
Yeah, I bet she has.
He's called Miguel. He's from Doncaster. Enid says he's really fit.
Well, he should be if he's a personal trainer.
Enid reckons Lois is absolutely asphyxiated with him.
All I'm saying is, you don't need expensive equipment to keep yourself trim.
People are prepared to spend a great deal of money on their training programmes, Beverly.
Are they?
The global fitness industry is worth billions.
That bloke on Dragon's Teeth made a fortune from opening gyms. Oh, what's his name?
Duncan Valentine.
That's him.
I've read his autobiography.
I didn't know he was dead.
He's not. He started out with one ice cream van.
Oh, you wouldn't get much gym equipment in one of those.
No, Shirley, he made his money from ice cream and then diversified.
Do you know, I may be able to help you out.
You're going to join my relay team?
No. But I cannot stand by and watch you risk your good name and reputation.
What do you mean?
What you're doing with that gym equipment could be construed as handling stolen property.
Well, Daz assured me it was salvaged.
Well, he would, wouldn't he? The question you have to ask yourself, Mr. Butt, is why your brother-in-law asked you to set the aforementioned equipment away in an unmarked vehicle after the hours of darkness and dispose of it for him incognito.
I thought you were going to sell it on eBay.
I don't think there's anything funny going on.
Ignorance is no defence under the law.
Oh, dear.
I put it to you that just by having the evidence in your van, you are in flagrante in locus delectus.
Am I?
And ex posto facto. You won't have a leg to stand on in court.
Oh, what am I going to do, Beverly?
Well, the obvious solution is for me to take the stuff off your hands, Mr. Butt.
Oh, I couldn't let you do that.
No, don't be silly. That's what friends are for.
But what will you do with two treadmills, a rowing machine and a load of weights?
I put them in the flat upstairs. I've always fancied opening a gym.
But you just said they were a waste of time.
No. I said that a waste of time in the hands of amateurs. With my sporting pedigree and my my knowledge of the human body, I'll be able to create a worthwhile and valuable service for the community and cash in on the fun run.
That flat upstairs is Nigel's, isn't it?
No, not really, Shirl. Well, let's go and have a look at it. Oh. Come on, you two. Oh. We can use the connecting door.
I can't be long, Beverly. In my position, I cannot afford tardiness or laxity.
Oh, you do use a lot of long words, Mr. Butt.
Mrs. Butt has accused me of being verbose.
Well, she should talk. She could do with losing a few pounds herself.
Oh, that's harsh. It's not as if you're morbidly verbose, is it, Mr. Butt?
No.
Oh! Mind those boxes. That's valuable stock.
Oh, the scissors sticking out the side. Oh, I'm bleeding.
Are you all right, Mr. Butt?
Don't encourage him, Shirl. It's just a scratch.
You'll have to move then, Beverly. Health and safety.
Oh, here we go. The pedant's revolt strikes again. Right. Highlight fitness suite and wellness spa.
Oh.
What do you think?
Ooh, well, it's a bit pokey.
It's a bit dusty.
It's perfect. I'll put the treadmills over there. The rowing machine is by the toilet and the weights can be where that camp bed is. We can charge them as they come into the salon and we send them upstairs.
Unsupervised?
No, I'll have CCTV. Make sure they don't nick anything.
The apparatus is very dirty, Beverly, from the fire.
Sure can clean it.
Well, if I've got a new mop, Bev, where's the spa going to be?
The bathroom, obviously.
Can I look after the treadmill? Graham says I need more amoebic exercise.
No, you're in charge of rowing, Shirl.
I can't swim.
What about Nigel?
Oh, yeah, he's a good swimmer. He used to be a lifeguard at the leisure centre.
No, you'll have to consult him about the gym. It's his flat.
Which he lent to me.
When you told him you were homeless.
I nearly was. Technically, I am still a sitting tenant.
So, are you actually paying rent?
No, it's a lousy flat.
So what makes you think it'll be suitable as a gymnasium?
Horses for courses, Mr. Butts.
I don't think you'll be allowed animals, Bev, especially upstairs.
Nigel's flat might not be great to live in, but it'll make an ideal bijou gym. Intimate, with a retro ambience that makes clients feel energised and empowered.
It's not much ventilation.
Exactly. It'll make them sweat like pigs. It'll be like that hot wigwam yoga. Come on, we'd better go back downstairs.
You'll have to pay Nigel some rent if you're using it as a business premises.
Well, obviously. Want to start making money?
I'll need the money up front, Beverly.
What money?
For the gym equipment.
But I'm doing you a favour. Taking all that heavy stuff out of your camper van. I thought you'd want to donate it.
Why would I do that?
Because you're the race marshal and always blathering on about the fun run and the good of the village.
Well, yes, but... Well,
you prefer to stop people getting fit and turning their lives around. People could die because of your avarice.
That's not fair.
No, I tell you what's not fair. It's you taking the credit for organising the charity fund run while your family make a profit out of it at the same time.
But you're going to charge them, Beverly.
A token amount. Plus a joining fee.
Well, isn't that excessive?
No, we need to get the money up front. Time is of the effluence. Strike while the ironing's hot.
The thing is, Beverly, I've promised Mrs. Butt I'll get some money for her brother.
But it's not even his to sell.
And now he's lost his job.
Because of his own incontinence, Mr. Butt.
Really?
Well, that's as maybe. But I can't go back to Mrs. Butt empty-handed. If you were to buy that stuff new, it would cost you nearly £8,000.
OK. I'll give you £250.
I couldn't take a penny less than £750.
£500?
Done.
Great. I'll pay you next month.
Oh, no. I must have the cash now.
Bev hasn't got any money. She's got a water retention problem.
What?
Right, go and get your coat, Mr. Butt. Shirl, come over by the toilet. I need a word.
I did the best I could with that mop, Bev.
No, it's not about that, Shirl. I need the donkey money. I'm thinking of your Tony.
Really?
But I was going to give him the chance to get in on my new fitness venture on the ground floor.
I thought it was upstairs.
Look, give me the 500, Shirl, and your Tony can have a job. After all, he hasn't worked since the sewage farm pulled the plug on him.
It wasn't his fault. Those valves all look the same.
Tell that to the 3,000 people who got food poisoning.
Oh, it did knock his confidence. Oh, all right, then. Here you are.
It's all here.
Yes. I will get it back, won't I?
Have I ever let you down, Shirl?
Well...
Exactly. Right, here you go, Mr. Butt. Oh. 500 smackers.
Oh, right. Well, I must be going. I'll drop it all off in the morning. Bye.
Bye. Right, get yourself upstairs then, Shirl.
What for?
The flat needs a good clean before the apparatus arrives.
Bev, I said they'd leave a donkey deposit at the bank tomorrow.
The donkeys don't know what day it is, Shirl. It's only a loan. I'm going to invest it for them.
But I promised the vicar. She's the treasurer of the donkey sanctuary. She won't be happy.
If she tries to create dysentery in the ranks, I'll tell you you've donated it to a more deserving charity.
Well, Highlights isn't a charity, is it?
Well, it's as good as. If we don't succeed, Shirl, we run the risk of failure.
Gonna build a big fence around my baby. Boy, build a big fence around my baby. Boy, I like everything that you do.
Oh, they're making a lot of noise up there, Bev. I can't concentrate.
So what's new, Shirl? How difficult is it to exfoliate 6 hairbrushes?
I'm just trying to get the hair out of them. Oh, dear, it sounds like they're going to come through the ceiling.
They're making a meal and moving a few bits of gym equipment.
That rear entrance is a bit tight. Mr. Butt was struggling to hold up his end.
I thought his layabout brother-in-law was helping him.
Sass? Yes, he seems to be doing all the work. Maybe I should take him a drink.
Just in case he takes his top off?
No. Mind he is very muscly.
If you like that kind of thing, Shirl. I prefer my men to be a bit more at market.
Like Richard Gere?
Oh, no, it's too full of himself. Look at me with the Dalai Lama on top of some Tahitian mountain.
Oh! That sounded like Dad. Oh, hope he's all right.
You know, it better not have damaged my equipment. He was always a bit heavy-handed.
Didn't you go out with him?
No, Shirl. Well, he asked me out, of course, but I knocked him back.
Oh, I thought he dumped you at the ice rink.
No, I don't think so.
You should never have told him that you were the British figure skating champion.
Right, what have we got in the book this morning?
We got a perm and a root retouch. We did have a couple of extensions, but they've changed their minds. They want it cut short for the fun run to be more hairodemonic.
You know, I knew that charity event would end up costing me money.
Oh, I haven't thought of that, Beth.
On the other hand, my new gym upstairs should make a tidy profit. Swings and roundabouts, show.
Are we having those as well?
Once they've got all the equipment into the flat, I want you to clean it. You can do it in your lunch hour.
I promised Graham I'd go for a jog at lunchtime. He's not very happy with me, or the dog.
Why?
He popped home yesterday to walk Curly and found my pedal meter on his tail.
Oh, dear. Well, you can jog on the spot while you're cleaning, and then I'll let you use the rowing machine.
For free?
No, you'll get a staff discount.
How much do we get off?
10%.
10%?
No, you're right, Shirl, you're right. Too generous. Make it 5. Now, come on, hurry up. Harriet's due in any minute now. She texted me first thing.
What's the vicar want?
A haircut.
Well, what if she asks me about the money I've raised from the fun run for the donkey sanctuary? She's the treasurer.
Tell her you've invested it in a high-yield adventure capital scheme.
I thought I'd lent it to you to buy the gym equipment.
You have. You don't have to tell her that.
Oh, I couldn't lie to her, Vicar Bev. It's 7 years bad luck.
Well, you've had 25 years bad luck being married to Graham. How much worse can it get?
Graham's lovely. Anyway, I get hiccups if I lie.
You don't have to lie, Shirl. Just don't tell Harriet the truth. Politicians do it all the time.
Do they?
Answer a question with the answer to another question. Look. Right, ask me what I'm doing tonight.
I thought you were going to the pictures.
Just ask me.
What are you doing tonight, Bev?
That's a very good question, but I'm more concerned about the plight of the homeless and the lack of cohesion in our community.
So you're not going to the pictures?
No. That was just an example of how to avoid a tricky question. Don't you get it?
Not really, Bev.
Oh, you'll just have to prevaricate.
I think I'll just waffle. Oh, what are they doing now?
They're fixing the treadmill to the floor.
So no one nicks it?
No, to stop it falling over if it's overloaded. Is Fat Rob doing the fun run?
Yes, he's collecting for the Vegetable Society.
But he runs a burger bar.
He wants to put something back. He's doing it in costume.
As a vegetable?
No, as a gorilla.
How will anyone tell the difference? Keep the noise down, will you? There's an artiste working down here.
Is there?
Yes, me. Do you think Beethoven could have composed the Nutcracker Suite with that racket going on?
Wasn't he deaf?
Oh, that's besides the point. All my customers are complaining!
All right! Oh, that's better.
Workmen are like children. They need to know where they stand.
Oh, I could never be forceful like you, Beth.
Leadership's a lonely 4-0, Shirl. Do you think I like being nasty?
Well,
It's like training a dog. Once you show them who's boss, they do as they're told.
Oh!
Bloody hell! Sorry,
Vicar. Morning, ladies. Don't worry, Beverly. I've heard worse. My first parish was in the East End of Glasgow.
Oh, sit yourself down in the wee chair, Minister. How are things at the Kirk?
Are you all right, Bev?
Yes, Shirl. Have you never heard of a Scottish accent before?
A laudable attempt at the vernacular.
We went on one of those when we went to the Isle of Man.
I beg your pardon?
It was ever so steep. Our Tonys always love railways.
I think you mean funicular, Shirley.
No, it was definitely the Isle of Man.
Right, Shirl, take a worship for this to Beauty Station number 3.
Sit down over here, Harriet.
Thank you, Shirley.
So what's it to be, Vicar?
Well, I'd like it short and streamlined, please.
Oh, yeah, like the rest of the gabardine swine.
I beg your pardon?
There you go, following the crowd.
Probably will be, Beverly. I'm afraid that my training isn't going as well as I'd hoped.
Oh, me neither.
I planned to run 5 miles a day last week, but Mr. Slackbottom's funeral rather derailed my schedule.
Oh, how inconsiderate of him to keel over and die at short notice.
I didn't mean it like that, Beverly.
I'm sure if he'd known it was so important to you, he'd have postponed it till after the race.
Wasn't he run over by the mobile library?
Damper a minute's down, Shirl.
All right.
I don't think you're being fair, Beverly.
Oh, don't talk to me about fair. This fun run's decimalised my business. Cheap hairdos and parking cones everywhere.
It is for a good cause. We're collecting lots of money, aren't we, Shirley?
Yes.
Well, as long as there's enough in the pot to cover my compensation claim for lost business. That's what this is a show.
What on earth is that? Is Nigel having some work done upstairs?
No, it's Bev's new apparatuses.
What apparatus?
She's opening a gym.
In Nigel's flat?
No, technically, it's my flat, Harriet. I'm a sitting tenant. Put your head back.
When are you opening?
Tomorrow.
Can't be very big. What kind of gym is it?
Very exclusive. We've already had to turn people down.
Have we?
We'll be offering a whole range of fitness programmes and spa treatments.
I'm in charge of the rowing. You don't even have to be able to swim.
You won't be doing dance classes, will you?
Oh, yes, yeah, if that's what my public demands.
Oh, dear. I hope you're not going to lure people away from my Christian Zumba sessions.
You shouldn't be offering that anyway.
Why on earth not?
Well, that's a contradiction in terms, isn't it? Mixing devil worship with Christianity.
Devil worship?
Well, it's voodoo, isn't it? Zumba.
It's a Colombian dance and fitness craze.
You know, for a practicing minister of the church, you are very naive, Harriet.
My divinity doctorate focused on pagan rituals.
Well, you should have paid a bit more attention then. Have you never seen Live and Let Die?
No.
Oh, that's Graham's favourite film. He's always modelled himself on Roger Moore.
Don't you mean Dudley Moore?
My Zumba classes are innocent fun. Voodoo arose from a set of spiritual folkways that developed from the traditions of the African diaspora.
Obviously, Harriet. Any fool knows that.
I didn't.
What they don't tell you is that all these South American cavortins are rooted in Satanism.
Like what?
The rumba, the samba, the pasodoble, all of them are about wanton desire and lewdity.
Even the hokey-cokey.
Well, my Zumba class helps raise money for the church roof.
Surely, you've got more important spiritual and moral matters to attend to. You really shouldn't be meddling in something you don't understand. Leave it to the professionals.
Won't the gym be rather noisy for your clients in the salon?
Don't worry, Harriet. We're having the whole of upstairs professionally soundproofed.
Are we?
Yeah, there's a bespoke acoustic carpeted surface being laid this afternoon.
What is it, Bev?
That rug that Enid found in a shed.
I hear you've done extremely well with your collection for the donkey sanctuary, Shirley.
Who told you that?
You did, yesterday, on the phone.
Oh.
I thought you were going to pay the money in at the post office, but Mr. Butt said you hadn't been in.
I've been busy.
Have you got the money with you?
Sort of.
You all right, Shirley?
Yes, fine, thank you.
I told you not to offer Eccles cake, Shirl. Do you like cakes, Vicar?
Well, I've forsworn them until after the fun run.
Me too.
So where is the £500, Shirley?
What?
The charity money.
That's a good question, but I'm more concerned with the flight of the hopeless and the lack of confusion in our community.
What?
Get off your soapbox. You'll ignore her, Vicar. She's always spouting politics to the clients, aren't you, Shirl?
Yes.
You can give me the 500, Shirley. I'll put it in the post office for
you. Shut your mouth, Harriet.
I beg your pardon?
I'm doing your fringe. I don't want you to swallow any hairs.
Oh, of course.
Shirl, get yourself upstairs and tell Daz and Mr. Butt to keep the noise down.
Now?
Yes. Go on. Is that enough off your fringe, Harriet?
Yes, I think so, Beverly.
Do you want me to do anything about the moustache?
I haven't got a moustache, have I?
Well, it looks worse in this light.
I had no idea.
No, I wouldn't worry about it, Harriet. Most average women of your age suffer with it.
I'm only 38.
Really? Oh. Well, I mean, although I've found that being beautiful can be a curse.
How?
Well, I've never had to try as hard as others.
No one's mentioned my facial hair before.
Well, they wouldn't, would they? And looks aren't really a requirement in your job. In fact, it's probably a bonus being a bit plain. Helps if you're trying to stay celibate.
I'm not a nun, Beverly. I have had relationships with men.
Mm-hmm, not for a while, Harriet.
No, would you advise me to depilate, then?
What you do in the privacy of your own home is your affair, Vicar. I'll just do the hairs on the back of your neck with the clippers. Lean forward, please.
Oh!
And keep still. Oh. If you want to get a bloat, you could start by losing a few pounds.
That's why I'm in training for the fun run.
Ah, that's short term. To tone up properly and get in trim, you need to join a gym and have a few spa treatments.
I'm not sure, Beverly.
Look, only a real friend like me would have the courage to tell you you're flabby and unappealing.
Oh, thanks.
Think nothing of it. If you sign up today, I can let you have platinum corporate membership at a specially reduced annual rate.
Oh, I've never been one for gyms. I hate being tied to a contract.
You've obviously got a deep-rooted problem with commitment.
I haven't. I am committed to my faith and the church.
Oh, we could all say that, Harriet.
You couldn't, Beverly. We'd never see you in church.
Some of us find more private, less showy ways of communing with our Maker.
You told me you were an atheist.
I am. Doesn't mean I don't believe in God.
I think you find it does.
That's you done, Harriet. I'm rather proud of that, given the raw material. Although, short hair exposes too much of your face.
I'm taking part in the fun run, not entering a beauty contest, Beverly.
Just as well. Have you ever given anything a real go, Harriet?
Of course I have. I've preached all over the world.
I moved on every time the going's got tough. It's no wonder your parishioners don't have any faith in you.
Who doesn't?
Enid, Lois, Beryl Birkinshaw and a few others who shall also remain nameless told me in confidence. Joining Highlight's fitness programme stacks up. It'll show you're not stuck up and you've got a stick in power and you're not a stick in the mud.
Will it?
I'm willing to design a personal wellness programme to your specific needs. What would you like to do?
Well, there is one thing I've always fancied having a go at, but you won't do it.
Try me, Harriet.
I've always had a yen for taekwondo.
We do that. What is it?
Korean kickboxing.
Yeah, we definitely do that. Well, a version.
Oh, how interesting. You do your own form?
Yeah, it's a mixture of Tai Chi and Kung Fu. Oh. It's called Tai Fu. Shall I put the kettle on?
If you've got a properly qualified instructor, I'll sign up.
Well, of course we have.
What, Dan?
No, he's called Tony. He's learnt from the very best.
In the Far East?
Yes, Norwich, I think.
What on earth is that?
Shirl's mobile. Oh. Shirl! Phone! It's Graham.
Coming! Answer it, will you, Beth?
Hello, Graham. No, she's upstairs with Daz. I don't know what they're getting up to, but they've been doing it for ages.
Oh, Graham, is everything all right? Oh, no, Bev told me to keep an eye on him, that's all. Nothing! Oh, I don't fancy him. No, I haven't had a chance to do my exercises, but I'm going to have a row at lunchtime. No, not on the canal, in Bev's new gym. Yes, upstairs in Nigel's flat. Oh, are you sure? Beryl? When?
Cheryl, give me that. Graham, unless you're ringing up for a haircut, I suggest you talk to your wife outside working hours. Goodbye.
Bev.
No need to thank me, Cheryl. What did he want?
He said he'd ring up at lunchtime to make sure I was doing my exercises.
It's only 11 o'clock.
Well, that's when Graham has his first lunch.
What about his 11s?
He has those at 9.
So when does he have his second lunch?
That's a bit of a manoeuvrable feast.
Well, I must be going. How much do I owe you?
200 for the gym membership and 40 for the haircut. Let's just call it 250, shall we?
I'll have to write a cheque out then.
Oh, that's fine. Cheryl, what was Graham saying about Beryl?
Oh, yeah. Apparently, Beryl Birkinshaw is moving into Nigel's flat next week.
She can't. What about me, Jim?
Maybe I'll leave the membership for the moment, Beverly.
No, I'll sort it out, Harry.
There's the £40. I'll get the £500 off you after the run on Friday, Cheryl.
Absolutely.
Bye.
Bye.
Oh, what did you tell her that for?
You asked me. Oh, what am I going to do about the donkey money if Nigel kicks you out?
That won't happen, Cheryl. As Napoleon said at the gates of Stalingrad, je ne regrette rien.
Oh, what does that mean?
They shall not pass. Well, when they say, go marching in. Well, when they say, go marching in. Oh, Lord, I want to be in that number.
I was born the running kind, with leaving always on my mind.
Good morning, Highlights Beauty Salon and Wellness Spa. Oh, hello, Margaret. Yes, you're booked in at 3. Why not come at 2 and give kickboxing a try? You can leave your mobility scooter around the back. Oh, please yourself, then.
Oh, Beth. Oh, I'm exhausted. Oh, I ran all the way from the post office.
No, you didn't, Cheryl. I watched you. You had to sit down in the bus shelter.
I had to. I almost dropped the wagon wheels.
So much for your diet.
Shall I put the kettle on?
No, we haven't got time. Nigel's due in 5 minutes.
To use the new gym upstairs?
Not for a haircut. Oh. Whatever you do, don't mention the gym.
It is his flat, Bev.
I'm the sitting tenant. I don't know what possessed you to sign up for that fun run.
I did it for the donkey sanctuary, Bev. I'm up to 3 minutes now. 5 minutes can't be that difficult.
What's 5 minutes got to do with
it? That's how long I've got to run for.
5K don't mean 5 minutes, Cheryl. It means 5 kilometres.
How long will that take me?
About a week.
Oh.
Even Lionel Christie can't run 5 kilometres in 5 minutes.
Oh.
Hang on, Cheryl. Careful how you pop those weights down. If they come through the ceiling and hit me, on your head be it.
What if I can't finish the fun run?
The donkeys will starve.
Oh, I'll have to do it then. But I gave you all the money I collected for your gym.
You'll get it back, Cheryl. I've taken 3 memberships over the phone this morning.
Can I have the £500 back then?
Oh, if only it were that simple. It's now part of my investment portmanteau. By investing in the gym, you're helping me, you're helping the village, and you're helping the donkeys.
How?
Well, the partners in the gym, aren't they?
Will they get gym membership?
No, they're sleeping partners. Mind, that's all they do. Lie around all day. I don't know why you're so bothered about them.
They've been rescued from all over Europe, Bev.
So we're letting foreign donkeys come over here to lie about and eat English grass?
They've all been neglected.
So have I. No one set up a sanctuary for me.
I've adopted an Albanian ass called Attila. Curly loves him.
I'm not surprised. It'll smell just like his dog food.
Do you know the difference between an ass and a donkey, Bev?
Oh, everyone knows that.
What is it, then?
Oh, I haven't got time to explain it in layman's terms, Cheryl.
Good morning, ladies.
Oh, hello, Nigel. Do you know the difference between an ass and a donkey?
Well, yes, all donkeys are asses, but not all asses are donkeys.
Nah, if only it were that simple, Nigel.
Oh, shh. What's that, Beverly?
Mice.
In my flat?
Well, you shouldn't have been so penny-pinching with the maintenance.
What about mules?
That's just another name for a donkey.
No, that's not correct, Beverly.
Oh, pardon me. I thought you were a butcher, not a vet.
I do know a little about animals.
Yeah, about killing them and chopping them up.
A mule is the sterile progeny of a male donkey and a female horse.
Ignore him, Cheryl. He's making it up as he goes along.
I am not.
Ooh, you are being forceful this morning, Nigel.
Stroppy, I'd call it.
Actually, it's the new me. I'm demonstrating my self-confidence and independence.
On your own?
I've just completed my assertiveness course.
Oh, Curly did one of those.
That was an obedience class, Cheryl. Fat lot of good it did.
That sausage dog taunted him.
So, why are you doing it, Nigel?
If you must know, Lois put my name forward to be a JP.
You?
Why not me?
I think it's nice. What kind of music are you going to play?
No, Cheryl. JP means Justice of the Peace.
Oh!
Yeah. Now, Beverly, while I'm here, I want to go upstairs to my flat and see what's going on.
Nothing's going on. But I don't want to be rude, Nigel, but surely you're too soft, indecisive and ineffectual to be a magistrate.
Yeah, that's why I've been on my course.
Assertiveness isn't something you can learn out of books, Nigel. It's in your genes.
I beg to differ, Beverly.
I don't think it's in mine, and I wear them a lot.
Beg all you want, Nigel, you're still wrong. Sit in that chair and let me cut your hair.
Thank you, but no, I've changed my mind. I don't want a haircut.
Oh, gratin, Nigel. You can't be upstanding, sitting on the bench, sending people down, looking like cat weasel.
One of my core learning outcomes is not caring what other people think about me.
Well, even if you look like a pot-sniffing hippie.
I don't look, do I?
Sit in the chair, Nigel.
All right, then. Just a short trip. Do I really look like a hippie?
Oh, your hair's terribly greasy.
Well, I washed it yesterday.
In butter?
I've given up butter. Except on sandwiches or toast or in cakes. Or scones.
Give me the spray, Cheryl. Nigel, lean back and keep your eyes and mouth closed.
That definitely isn't mice.
Probably rats, then. So, Nigel, what on earth possessed you to want to become a JP?
Well, I've been thinking about it for a while, and I'd like to put something back, Beverly. Make a real difference to people's lives.
By locking them up and making them homeless?
No.
I agree. Most of them deserve it, if not worse.
I believe in rehabilitation, giving people a second chance.
I wouldn't give them a first chance. Some of them should be locked up at birth.
That's a very negative view of society, Beverly.
Learnt in the School of Hard Knocks. You'll have to change your name.
Why?
Well, there's a lot of nasty people out there who'll be after you. Do you think Judge John Deed is really called John Deed?
Oh, no. He's Martin Bodie.
And I wouldn't be happy with some investigator pouring over all my most intimate details.
I've got nothing to hide, Beverly.
As long as you've never had a speeding ticket or looked at a dodgy website, you'll be fine.
They won't do that, will they?
They'll trawl a comb through every detail of your personal life, interview your previous lovers.
Oh.
No, don't worry. I won't tell them anything.
Well, there's nothing to tell.
Well, that's the line I'll be giving him. Put me down as a character reference.
No, that's very kind, but...
Cheryl will be a referee too, won't you, Cheryl?
What?
You'll be a referee.
Oh, I don't know anything about football.
Look, someone told me that they'd seen heavy equipment being moved into my flat yesterday.
Who told you?
Are you or are you not running a gym in my flat?
I've never heard anything so ridiculous in all my life. Whoever said that is a liar and a charmeleon.
Well, Harriet's the most honest person I've ever met.
The vicar. I might have known.
So you are running a gym?
No! 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 Absolutely not.
Okay, that is coming from our flat. It sounds like a dance class.
No, it's kickboxing.
Cheryl, shut that door.
You lied to me, Beverly. You swore that you were not running a gym.
I'm not. It's a wellness spa.
Isn't that just semantics?
That doesn't start until six.
Are you in on this as well, Shirley? Well,
of course she is, Nigel.
It was a joint decision. I just went along with it.
Oh, this is ridiculous. I'm going up there to have a look.
I haven't finished your hair yet, Nigel. Hold him down, Shirley.
Oh.
Look, it's my flat and you're running an illicit business in it.
How dare you? My businesses are totally illicit.
You've taken advantage of my good nature for the last time. I let you have my flat when you told me you were homeless.
I was.
You were just having your bedroom decorated.
Oh, I didn't realise I was dealing with the Stasi. You'll be ordering me to wear an ankle tag next.
That Rob had one of those. Reckoned if he put it in the microwave, the police couldn't track him.
Did it work?
Yeah, but he didn't get very far. The microwave had one of those short leads. It only stretched as far as the pantry.
The fact remains that the flat belongs to me. This isn't personal, Beverly.
How can anything between us not be personal, Nigel, given our history? Can you forget the passions of the past so easily?
It's true I had feelings for you, Beverly. But you made it crystal clear that you didn't reciprocate.
When?
At the National Transport Enthusiasts Convention. You called me the most boring, dozy dullard you'd ever met, and you never wanted to see me again.
You've never understood women, Nigel. That was just a lover's tiff.
Ah.
Lovers? We never even kissed.
Oh, you never gave it time. It was all sex with you, isn't it?
Chance would be a fine thing. I've had the shop next door for 7 years. At the start, I used to have my hair cut 3 times a week just to see you. I brought you chocolates, flowers...
And tripe.
And they say romance is dead.
Well, it wasn't just tripe. It was black pudding and sausages and other high-quality meat products. But you always knocked me back,
right,
Beverly.
So this is revenge then, Nigel?
No. I don't have your sang-froid.
No, probably not.
Who's got it then?
This hasn't got anything to do with you and me, Beverly. I didn't even know you were still using the flat.
Apology accepted, Nigel. As long as this isn't a ploy, it's getting under the radar on the ground floor of the upstairs gym.
No, the gym has to go. I've promised the flat to Beryl Birkinshaw as a favour to Gordon. She's moving in at the weekend.
Oh, talk about local corruption.
What do you mean?
I bet you wouldn't have been so keen to help his mother if Gordon wasn't the local Bobby. Rubbing shoulders with your bosom buddies in the police while you scratch their backs behind my back. You've got some front.
That is an outrageous slander.
No, I tell you what's outrageous. All your secret Masonic Club Rotary Lodge societies with your funny handshakes and secret whistles and winks.
I'm not a member of any secret society.
What about the one we went to? Hat badges, little black books and funny names.
The East Midlands Transport Enthusiasts Association is hardly a secret society.
There were some very strange people there. Police Sergeant Gordon Birkinshaw being one of them.
Gordon was only there as security after what happened in 95.
What did happen?
The workshop branch gate crashed the plenary when we were debating coach liveries. It got very messy very quickly.
Graham's mum came from work, so...
Yeah, they're a nasty bunch. Lean forward, Nigel, while I do your neck.
Letting my flat to Beryl Birkinshaw is purely business, Beverly.
Can I remind you that I'm a tenant sitting under the law?
You've never paid any rent.
Yeah, because it was a right tip. Boxes everywhere.
They were yours. You were using it as a storeroom.
Well, I think it's outrageous that you're prepared to dump on your mates so you can get special favours.
Like what?
Well, there aren't any traffic cones in front of your shop, are there?
There's a double yellow line, Beverly.
Which you will be able to park on with gay abandon now. Oh. Nobody's going to give you a ticket when the policeman's mother's living in your flat.
What are they doing up there?
Oh. I did not. Don't be ridiculous. Oh. OK, fine, just go. Yeah. Go.
I want my money back, Beverly.
No refunds, Enid.
What's happened to your nose?
Your useless son kicked me in the face.
Oh, I'm sure he didn't mean to.
You must have got in the way.
Trained instructor, my backside. Your Tony knows as much about Korean boxing as I know about breeding chinchillas.
Right, I'm going to have a look at my flat.
No!
Come back!
Oh, yes.
Brilliant. Why didn't you stop him, Shirley?
I don't know.
I've been badly injured doing one of your classes, Beverly. I'm going to sue you.
You can't. You signed a form devoiding yourself of reliability, Enid. Besides, there's nothing wrong with you.
I might need plastic surgery.
I've always needed plastic surgery. Anyway, you'll have to sue Nigel. He's the landlord. I'm just the lowly downtrodden tenant.
We had a chinchilla once.
What?
It escaped and lived under the floorboards. It survived by eating Graham's socks. Well, I say survived. It didn't last very long.
Beverly! Beverly! This has to stop now!
We haven't got started yet.
There's 2 tons of gym equipment and a paddling pool. Have you had that floor testing?
Of course I have.
She got Fat Rob to jump up and down for an hour.
An hour?
Well, he got tired after 10 minutes.
I'm extremely worried about your unlicensed and unregulated gym injuring friends of mine.
Neither of your friends are members. It's typical. Shutting down a community initiative for charity.
You charged me, Beverly.
I have to cover my overheads, Enid.
Well, everyone wants their membership money back.
What about the donkeys?
You've signed up donkeys?
Beth says they're only sleepy partners.
Hand it over, Beverly.
You should know, Enid, that renegading on your responsibilities will have dire consequences.
Like what?
The needless slaughter of dozens of defenceless dumb animals.
Oh, no, please, Enid, don't kill the donkeys. Give it another try.
Yeah, forget kickboxing. Try something else.
Oh, well, I'm not sure. What other martial arts do you do?
Shirley, is your Tony any good at fencing?
Yeah, he painted next doors last weekend, 2 coats.
Enid, how about weightlifting? You've always had a lovely figure. Tone up.
Oh, I might give it a try. Have you got any of those dodgy tablets that all the athletes take?
Anacarbolic steroids. They're meant to be really bad for you.
Oh, they give you a nasty temper.
Well, you must have eaten a hatful, Beverly. I didn't want to do taekwondo. I was promised aquazumba.
I know, but that starts next week when we've repaired the paddling pool.
Well, your Tony had better not be taking it, Shirley.
Oh, no, he can't swim.
I must say, Beverly, I'm very unhappy about water-based activities being conducted in my flat. I'll have to turn the water off.
Are we living in Victoria times? Have you never read the Magna Carta? We hold these truths to be evidently right, that all men are equal and have the right to a bath or a shower.
No, I'm going to call the parish council, organise a proper health and safety inspection and close you down.
Over my dead body. I've done my own inspection and there's nothing wrong with it.
Forgive me if I don't have confidence in your appraisal. Good day, I must run.
Bye, Nigel.
Well, if you break your leg, don't come running back to me.
If you train yourself to fit the world, there won't be nothing left. Just a little here and a little there. You all know yourself.
Tammy, we're down here.
Do I have to?
Right, that treadmill is for bona fide gym members. I'll have to dot you ages.
I thought it was a 15-minute free trial, Bev.
Well, not when you're supposed to be working in the salon.
Oh, jiggered. They only had 200 to go.
How far have you run?
50.
50 metres?
I did burn off 7 calories.
Well, you were eating when you went up the stairs.
That was an energy bar.
It was a Mars bar. You lost 7 calories and put on a couple of hundred.
I'm pacing myself.
The fun runs tomorrow, Shirl.
Oh, hello, Mr. Butt. You're a bit early for the post.
My current preoccupation is somewhat more pressing than being the purveyor of the post, Shirley.
Have you delivered those promotional leaflets about my new gym yet?
I don't think it's a good idea, Beverly.
That's why you're a run-of-the-mill postmaster and I'm a visionary businesswoman. See, once the word gets out, I'll be flooded with new members.
That's what I'm worried about. You've got to get rid of the gym equipment. Daz had no right to sell it.
Possession is 12/5 of the law, Mr. Butt. Considering it was fire damaged, I paid your worthless brother-in-law good money for the apparatus.
The insurance company is investigating the conflagration of the caravan site.
I thought it burnt down.
That's Daz's problem. He's the caretaker.
The police are after him. He's done a runner.
Why?
They think it was arson. We've got to get rid of the evidence, Beverly.
Well, I'm not giving it back. Technically, it's not my responsibility.
The sale was transacted between you and Daz, Beverly. You're the proprietor.
No, that's where you're wrong. The equipment belongs to Shirley. She paid for it, didn't you, Shirl?
I only lent you the money, Bev.
That was adventure capital. You've jazzled the 500 quid from the donkey sanctuary.
I told Harriet I'd give her the collection money tomorrow.
You shouldn't make promises you can't keep, Shirl.
You promised I'd get it back.
Look, Beverly, I can't afford to jeopardise my reputation by being caught up in a scandal. I insist that you divest yourself of that gymnasia paraphernalia.
Now, my fitness emporium is doing really well. I've got women queuing up to join me classes.
Can I have my money back, then?
No. But, Mr. Butt, if you're that worried, I'll cut my own throat and sell it all back to you for £2,000.
You'll pay 500. But we need to get rid of it all so that when we're questioned by the police, we have credible deniability.
Ah, right, I see. Do you think you could deny something incredibly to the police, Shirl?
No.
Oh, no.
Oh, I'm sorry.
No, a police car's just pulled up.
It's Wendy. What do I say if she questions me?
Nothing.
Morning, Beverly. Shirley. Oh, hello, Mr. Butt.
I love donkeys, Wendy. I wouldn't ever take advantage of them, and if I had any money, I don't think they'd mind if I borrowed it, if they knew I was helping them, even if I didn't, straight away. I'd never do anything to hurt dumb animals or even clever ones.
I'm sorry, Shirley. You've lost me.
Ignore her, Wendy. She's seen too many wildlife documentaries. She's obsessed with grilled bears.
Well, I must be going.
Wait a minute, Mr. Butt. I wanted a word.
Oh, I haven't got time now, Wendy. I've got important post office business to attend to. The populace of Bridgeford depend on my moral rectitude.
This is quite important.
I would be sorely missed if I was unable to prosecute my responsibilities as a citizen and postmaster.
And race marshal.
All right. I'll pop in this afternoon.
I'm closing early. Bye then.
Oh, I only wanted to talk to him about road closures for the race.
So what can I do for you today then, Wendy? Washing a trim?
No, I haven't come for a hairdo.
Oh, no. Have you come to arrest me?
Very funny, Shirley. I've come to look at the gym.
Oh, well, you're in luck. We're still accepting new members. We have a special discount for the emergency services.
Actually, Beverly, I've been ordered here by Gordon and the parish council. Nigel's made a complaint about the business you run in his flat upstairs.
Oh, I might have known. Hell hath no fury like a butcher's scorn.
What do you mean?
Nigel always gets vindictive whenever I spurn his amphibious advances. He tries to ruin things for me.
That doesn't sound like
He's a classic example of an antisocial psychopath. He's got all the symptoms.
What? Safety of others.
Isn't it St. John's ambulance?
I've never thought of him as deceitful and manipulative with a disregard for the law.
He's got a deep-rooted psychic disorder. He kills animals for a living.
He's a butcher. I don't think he actually kills them, Beverly.
Well, he chops them up. Nigel's so full of anger and bitterness. Mine, he's not the only one, is he, Shirl?
No, lots of people have it in for you.
I didn't realise you'd trained in psychology, Beverly.
Well, I don't practice anymore. Well, obviously, my expertise comes into play through hairdressing. People feel a need to share with me, don't they, Shirl?
Oh, yeah. You always wheedle it out of them in the end.
Nigel's worried that his flat won't hold a lot of people and heavy equipment. If I could just take a quick look upstairs...
No, I don't think so. Everyone knows you've got an invested interest in moving your mother-in-law into Nigel's flat.
I resent that. Beryl can live with me and Gordon as long as she wants.
Oh, come on, Wendy. We all know how difficult Beryl Birkinshaw can be.
Gordon says it's not her fault. She's in a lot of pain.
Is she still suffering with that trapped psychotic nerve?
It seems to come and go without warning.
Yeah, funny how she always develops mysterious exotic symptoms when you and Gordon are about to jet off somewhere.
Yeah, or even just a night out.
What was it forced you to cancel the trip to San Francisco and Alcatraz?
Suspected dengue fever.
Yeah, not bad for someone who's never been further than Mablethorpe.
Beryl was worried she might have contracted it from a friend who went to Knowsley Safari Park.
And had she?
No. She turned the central heating up too high.
Oh, that was lucky.
Oh, Gordon was devastated.
Because of the heating bill?
No, about missing Alcatraz.
Oh, yeah, he loves his prisons, doesn't he?
Next year he's promised to take me to Devil's Island.
Me and Graham went there.
Where? South America?
No, Northumberland. But I don't remember seeing any prisons there.
I think you mean Holy Island, Shirl.
Oh, yeah.
Look, Beverly, the sooner you let me look at the gym, the sooner I'll be out of your hair.
Shouldn't you be out catching criminals instead of harassing innocent fitness gurus?
If only. Gordon pulled me off the fire.
Oh.
No, the one at the caravan site. I was the one who worked out it was arson. Gordon thought it was an accident.
Well, maybe it was.
No, I spent 3 hours on my hands and knees sifting through the ashes.
Oh, look at your nails, they're ruined.
I found a tin of lighter fuel close to where the fire started.
Well, it could have been kids. I've had a crafty fag.
That's what Gordon said. But when I went to talk to the caretaker, he did a runner.
Well, that doesn't prove anything. Daz was probably training for the fun run.
In his work boots. He didn't come back. And we found £500 in his caravan.
Oh, no.
The blaze could have been caused by lightning.
It was a clear night, Beverly.
Perfect conditions for spontaneous combustion, then.
I doubt it. Anyway, it's not up to me anymore. As soon as Gordon realised it was a proper case, he took over.
Typical Gordon, hogging all the kudos.
I thought he was on a diet.
Look, Beverly, if it isn't me, they'll send someone else to inspect the gym.
Well, I'll have to give you a manicure before you go.
Why?
Hygiene regulations. I can't have you poking around my state-of-the-art wellness centre with half a ton of German filth under those nails.
I wasn't intending to touch anything.
Shirl, beauty station number two. And break out the emergency manicure set.
All right. Oh. Where is it?
That shoebox under the sink.
Oh.
I'll need 10 cotton swabs. The cuticle pusher. The heavy-duty file and the callus remover.
Is that really necessary, Beverly?
Do I tell you how to do your job, Wendy?
Yes.
All right, sit down. Chill. Chrome forceps.
What?
Pass me the clippers.
Oh, right.
This won't hurt.
Ow!
Well, sit still, you big baby. Just pushing back your cuticles. All right.
Fine. Oof.
Are you sure you cut out for the police?
It's all I ever wanted, Beverly.
Yeah, but you thought you'd be solving murders and foiling terrorists, and here you are, worried about traffic cones and dog fouling. I'm putting your hands into soap, Wendy.
Oh, this is very hot.
It's supposed to be. Oh, you're too good for all the petty crime, Wendy. You did a degree. Domestic science, wasn't it?
Forensic science, but I dropped out.
What happened?
I met Gordon. He had this mad romantic idea to go globetrotting.
With his feet?
Yeah. We packed up and moved to New Zealand.
Oh, what an adventure.
Not really. We had to come back after a week. Beryl called Gordon from the hospital.
Why?
She had lockjaw.
How did she talk if she had lockjaw?
I bet she was tight-lipped.
Was she all right?
Oh, yeah. Turned out she'd just overdone the polygrip.
You know, if you hadn't let Gordon wrap you round his little finger, turn your head and sweep you off your feet, you could have followed your dream, Wendy.
One of these days, I'm going back to academia.
Where the nuts come from.
What?
Academia nuts, our Graham loves them.
Right, and now for the nail varnish. Severed artery red to fire you up.
I'm not sure Gordon would approve.
Nah, he's just jealous. You know, you should go back to New Zealand, Wendy.
Gordon would never leave Beryl.
Well, that's his problem. You owe it to yourself to fulfil your full utensil.
I don't know. Gordon's always been very loyal to me.
Has he? He's forced you to give up university to follow his pipe dream.
But,
Well, he didn't like you wearing nail varnish and he scuppered your promotion to sergeant.
He didn't. He put a good word in for me, Bev.
That's not what he told us, is it, sure?
What?
Well, he said he was doing you a favour. He didn't think you were ready.
Why would he do that?
You're younger, brighter. He's always been scared of you showing him up.
You think so?
Life's too short, Wendy. Throw off the shackles of male oppression. As Jerome Greer said, at first you'll be afraid, you'll be petrified, thinking you can't live without Gordon by your side, thinking how he did you wrong, but you'll grow strong.
You will survive.
Don't interrupt, Shirl.
Isn't that Gloria Gaynor?
No, well, she might have put it to music. All I'm saying, in a caring and compassionate way, is that you have to dump Gordon and make a new life for yourself.
I don't think I haven't thought of it, Beverly, but he needs me.
What for? To do the washing up and apply the fungal cream.
Has that still not cleared up?
No.
Your choice, Wendy. Most people end up settling for second best, don't they, Shirl?
If they're lucky.
You're right. I'm going to follow my dream.
Well, the travel agent's open till 6.
What about the police?
Oh, they can get stuffed.
Good for you, Wendy. Well, that's your nails beautiful again. Give me the £30 and you can be on your way.
I suppose I'll still need to inspect the gym.
Well, you don't have to now. That's your old life.
They'll only send someone else. I'll have a quick look and make sure you pass the inspection.
Well, it can't be long. We're booked up.
I'll come and do a bit more on the treadmill.
Well, this handrail's loose.
It's meant to be like that. Ta-da! Feast your eyes on Bridgford's new wellness spa. Treadmill, row machine, spa in there.
The toilet?
Well, we prefer the term wet room. Over there is the tranquility suite.
What?
It's the bedroom.
What goes on in the tranquility suite?
Meditation.
And kickboxing.
It smells smoky in here.
Oh, it's my perfume. Smouldering Passion by Yves Gauche.
I think it's the equipment. Is that suit?
No, it's a state-of-the-art protective coating put on by the factory.
Can I use the treadmill now?
Oh, go on then.
That doesn't sound too healthy.
No, it's no good at slow speeds. Shirl, rev it up a bit. Show Wendy what it can do.
I get dizzy if I go faster, Beth.
No, it's just for a minute. Look, let me do it. Oh. Right, that sounds better.
Bev, I can't keep up.
Stop it! Stop it!
Press the override button,
you're
Cheryl.
Beverly, pull the plug out!
There!
Are you all right, Shirley?
Leave her down there. It's all part of a routine.
I can't see your fire escape.
It's over there.
Where?
Through the kitchen window, onto the flat roof. Or they could just lie down in the paddling pool till the flames die down.
God, I've seen enough.
I told you there won't be a problem, Wendy.
This is a death trap.
Oh, you're just nitpicking.
I'll have to put it in my report. I better go.
I'll come down with you. I think I've had enough.
Careful on that handrail, Shirley.
What?
Are you all right?
I warned you about that handrail, Beverly.
I saw you. You pulled it off deliberately.
Oh, don't be absurd. Shirley could sue you for that.
Do you know, I've had enough of your impotence, Wendy. I've a good mind to report you to the PDSA for harassment.
Who?
The Police Complaints Authority. If nosy parkers like you had been around 100 years ago, Isabel Duncan Brunel would never have invented the television.
I thought that was Yogi Bear.
No, we invented penicillin.
I think that was Alexander Fleming.
Don't be stupid. He wrote James Bond.
I wonder if I'll need penicillin for my leg, Bev. It's ever so sore.
Nonsense. You'll run it off in the race.
Maybe I shouldn't run tomorrow.
You've got to. What about the money?
I'd have to give it back if I don't do the fun run.
That's not going to happen. You're going to have fun whether you like it or not.
Because you're good girls are gonna go bad. I'm gonna be the swinginest swinger you've ever had. If you like them painted up, powdered up, then you ought to be glad. Cause you're good girls are gonna go bad. Oh yeah, you're good girls are gonna go bad.
Now the race is
oh, Cheryl, where the hell have you been?
Oh, I had to go to the medical tent.
Well, everyone else finished the fun run half an hour ago.
Who won?
The vicar, but I reckon she had help. Some kind of intervention.
Divine.
No, drugs more like.
But Harriet's the chair of the donkey sanctuary.
Attention seeker. They're all the same, these do-gooders.
Oh, the first aider said I should go home and rest my leg.
Oh, no, no, you don't, Cheryl. I need you in here. I've got to keep an eye on the gym.
Is it busy?
Overflowing. I'm finally making a healthy profit, but I won't be if you're sat at home watching Loose Women in the Attic.
Could I pop up and have a quick shower then?
No! The gym is for paying members only. Loyal, valued and trusted customers. Hey, you lot! Keep the noise down, and no more than four in the spa at any time.
Oh, have you fixed the leak in the paddling pool?
Yep, a bit of gaffer tape and a squirt of hair lacquer. Good as new.
That's clever.
Necessity is the brother of invention, Cheryl.
Is he? Oh, couldn't I go upstairs and have a paddle, Bev? My leg's killing me.
No, and I'm going to have to dock you wages for being absent without leave this morning.
I had a problem just after the start. I struggled to get past the cake shop.
You usually do, Cheryl.
I'm carrying an injury, Bev. From when I fell down your stairs yesterday.
Don't even think about claiming against my insurance.
You haven't got any insurance.
It was your own malnegligence. There's nothing wrong with you.
There is, Bev. It's me ankle. Fat Rob reckoned I could have torn me Archimedes.
Well, he should know.
You think so?
Yeah, running a burger bar is as good as going to medical school.
Well, what am I going to do about the money I collected for the donkey sanctuary, Bev?
Tell Harriet you lost it.
I can't lie to a vicar.
Well, what's the alternative? Tell everyone you've embellished the funds?
I didn't! I lent them to you to buy the gym equipment!
Hey, you'll get your money back.
Well, can I have it now, then?
No, oh. It's an investment. It'll take a couple of months. Probably 18.
Oh, it's not my day, Bev. I can't give Harriet the money. I didn't finish the fun run and I may have to go to hospital.
That's brilliant, Cheryl.
What, me going to hospital?
No, not finishing the race. It's karma.
I'm not calm.
By failing to complete the stimulated distance, you've mollified your obligation to hand over the donkey sanctuary money. Harriet, can whistle for it.
But what about all the people who supported me, Bev? I'm going to have to give them their money back.
The individual donators gave to charity and that's where it's gone.
You just said you were making a wealthy profit.
Highlights Gym and Wellness Spa is a commercial communal amenity for the whole community.
What about the donkeys?
We'd never get them upstairs. Health and safety.
I feel guilty, Bev. I won't be able to look them in the eye. They're supposed to be very intelligent animals.
Well, compared to you, they might be.
Good morning, Beverly. Good morning, Shirley.
Oh, hello, Beryl.
Beryl Birkinshaw. We don't see you in here very often. What do you want?
Gordon's asked me to look at Nigel's flat upstairs. I thought he'd get my hair done whilst I was here.
I thought Charmaine Blewett usually did yours.
Oh, not anymore. She was very rude to me.
About your ball patch?
What bolt patch?
Nothing. Now, come on, sit down. Beauty station number 2, Shirley.
Over here, Beryl.
Oh, thank you, Shirley.
So, what did Charmaine say to upset you?
She suggested my chronic back pain was psychosomatic and I should give my mobility scooter to someone more needy.
No one's more needy than you, Beryl.
I know. I mean, so what if I run down to the front when I won at bingo? I told her it was a momentary release from years of agony. Thought I'd won top prize.
What did you win?
6 pork chops and a packet of wet wipes. I wouldn't care, but I've been taught to avoid red meat.
So's Graham. But he's got one of those George Formby grills. Reckons you can eat as much meat as you want.
I have to be very careful.
Well, you've always had a delicate constituency, Beryl.
I know. I've been advised I need a gluten-free, dairy-free, low-fat diet.
Would you like a cup of tea, Beryl?
Oh, thanks, Shirley. Milk, 2 sugars and no more than 4 biscuits.
There's nothing on you, Beryl. You're like a bird.
Yeah, a dodo.
What did you say?
I said you'll have to speak up. Shirley's as deaf as a dodo.
I heard that.
Right, bend your head back, Beryl, while I wash your hair.
Oh, ow! Oh, it's hot!
It's supposed to be. It's vernacular stimulation.
Come on, lady!
Is that racket coming from upstairs?
It's both you, Jim.
In Nigel's flat?
Just a minute.
I won't tell you again. Turn that racket down or I'll rebuke your membership.
How many people have you got up there?
Oh, it's just a few clients warming down after the fun run. In fact, you could join yourself, Beryl. We do a special OAP rate.
For my dead body.
Chance would be a fine thing.
Here's your tea, Beryl, and your 4 hobnobs.
Oh, thanks, Shirley.
Oh, I nearly fell over. Oh, there's a big puddle on the floor. The paddling pool must be leaking.
Don't be silly, Shirley. You must have spilt the tea. Here, Beryl, let me towel you down.
According to Gordon, I'm meant to be moving in upstairs next week.
Well, you can think again. I'm the sitting tenant.
Oh, I wouldn't go telling Gordon that. He's like a bear with a sore head.
Sit up straight while I go round the back.
What's the matter with Gordon?
Last night, halfway through University Challenge, Wendy walked out.
Well, don't blame her. It's very difficult.
No, she's left him. Said she's going to resign from the police and go off and find herself.
She's always been hot-headed and impetuous.
Apparently, she had a long heart-to-heart with someone in the village and they put her up to it.
Oh, dear.
That's dreadful. What an interfering busybody.
I'd like to shake their hand.
Really?
Yes. Wendy Shufflebottom's always been a bit flaky.
That's rich coming from you.
She was never good enough for my Gordon. I mean, who does she think she is, swanning off to New Zealand?
The Shufflebottoms have always had itchy feet.
How is Gordon's fungal problem?
Not so hot. I don't think that ointment was up to scratch. And let's face it, Wendy walking out isn't going to help Gordon's feet.
Maybe she'll change her mind, Beryl.
Oh, I hope not. She had him wrapped round a little finger. Gordon bent over backwards and jumped through hoops to keep her sweet. Oh, an ordinary bathroom wasn't good enough for her. She'd have her own wet room.
Oh, yeah. Gordon got fat robbed to polyurinate the toilet floor.
Yes, and he didn't do a very good job. Those fumes are still playing havoc with my bronchial tubes. And then, as soon as it's all finished, she's off like a rat up a drainpipe.
Oh, I hate rats.
So do I.
Well, you wouldn't like Nigel's flat, then it's invested with them.
Is it?
Wendy may have done you a favour by leaving, Gordon. You've dodged a bullet there, Beryl.
Oh, no. Gordon's determined to win Wendy back.
Oh, that's nice.
Not for me, it isn't. He reckons if to have any chance, I've got to move out.
At your age? Being put on the streets by your only son just to satisfy his carnal desires.
I thought Gordon was a vegetarian.
Everyone knows that moving house is one of the most stressful things you can put a person through.
And I've been taught to avoid stress. I mean, it's not as if I'd been any trouble. Why on earth would Wendy think I was a hindrance?
She did have to cut short her dream holiday because of your mystery illness.
Well, excuse me for wanting my only son with me on my deathbed.
But it was just a cold.
Now, Wendy wasn't to know that the doctor had misinterpreted the symptoms, was she, Beryl?
No! I didn't get one word of sympathy. Oh, I suffered in silence.
How would she know if you didn't say anything?
Right, Beryl. Time to get the foils on. Shirl, go and get the tungsten blue for me.
Okay. Oh, hello, Gordon.
Morning, Shirley. Harriet's asked me to collect the donkey sanctuary money from you. Have you got it?
No. I've given it away.
What?
Can't you see? She's injured. She wasn't able to finish. She's going to have to give it all back.
Harriet said the donkeys were desperate for that money.
Oh, dear.
Don't stop mixing, Shirl. What's that you've got in your hand, Gord? Not another one of your petitions.
No. It's Wendy's health and safety report on the illegal gym. It's the last thing she gave me before she walked out.
I'm sorry about that.
I'm not.
Mother?
What are you doing here?
What does he look like, having my hair done?
After everything you said about this place.
What did she say?
Nothing.
Yes, you did. You said Highlights offered a shoddy service and was a hotbed of malicious gossip.
I was talking about the post office, Gordon.
I don't think so.
Excuse me, Sergeant Birkinshaw. If you've just come here to be rude, I think you should leave.
Actually, I'm here on official police business. My wife has left the door open.
Oh, that might have been me.
No. Wendy's thrown me a signal and given me a lifeline.
What, from New Zealand?
This damning report on your gym is proof that she wants me back.
I don't get it.
Wendy's telling me there's a way back for us if I move my mother out of the marital home and into the flat upstairs.
Which you just condemned.
You can't close down a successful small business just because of your lustful carnage.
You don't have planning permission.
I don't need it. A few people are enjoying themselves and you want to pour cold water on it.
I think that drip's getting worse, Bev.
No, it's just a bit of over-exuberance in the spa.
How many people have you got up there?
12.
3.
I better have a look myself.
No, you can't go up. They might not be decent.
Don't you tell me what to do, Beverly. I am an officer of the court.
See? He's like a bear with a sore head.
In a china shop.
We were all very sorry to hear about Wendy, but there's no need to take it out on us, Gordon.
But that's rich. You were the one who put Wendy up to it.
Well, all I did was listen. It's a gift. People feel the need to unburden themselves to me, don't they, Cheryl?
Oh, yes. No one can keep a secret from you, Bev.
What did Wendy say?
I'm sorry, Gordon. I'm bound by my vow of hairdressing confidentiality.
Everything was all right until you poked your nose in.
Oh, you're in denial, Gordon.
I'm not!
No, you and Wendy were never suited.
Personally or professionally.
Well, that's not true. It was me who helped to join the police force.
And then became jealous of her success.
I never.
You took her off the caravan site fire just when she was getting warm.
I thought the case needed someone with more maturity.
Well, you're certainly mature. You see, in fact, with Wendy gone, you'll be needing some help. You could deputise me.
What as?
A detective. I'd solve the caravan site fire inside 24 hours.
How?
I'd grill one of my stool pigeons.
Oh.
If you must know, I arrested Daz this morning.
Oh, dear.
Did he come clean?
He admitted the theft of the gym equipment, but refused to elaborate further.
Phew.
He probably acted alone.
I'll get him to talk when I've won Wendy back.
Don't hold your breath, son.
It gives me no pleasure to say this, Gordon, but someone has to put the head above the pulpit. You and Wendy were always on a hiding to nothing, given the age difference.
No, that's what I told him right at the start.
Wendy said it wasn't a problem.
Well, she would say that, wouldn't she? We've all been dazzled by an older man in uniform.
Oh, yes. I remember the first time I saw Graham in his dress uniform.
In the army?
The gas board.
But Wendy and I really loved each other, Beverly.
I'm sure she was infatuated with you at the start, Gordon, but then she noticed the pitying looks and the cruel smirks.
She never said anything.
Well, you're too comfortable on your perch, but she wanted to fly away. Let her go, Gordon. Let her soar like an eagle and feel the wind beneath her wings.
No. No matter how far she goes, I'll run after her to the ends of the earth.
What, with your feet? You'll be lucky to get to the end of the street.
Wendy's coming back. I know she is.
I hope not.
Mother!
Well, she never liked me. She spent the whole time trying to evict me.
You can't blame Wendy for that. You said you're only staying for a week. That was 3.5 years ago.
Oh, pardon me for breathing. You see, Beverly? She's turned my illness against me.
Oh, I've had enough of this. I'm going upstairs.
You know, all this inspection nonsense is a dead herring.
Is it?
A smokescreen. He's not bothered about my planning permission. He wants to close me down.
And dump me in a damp, rat-infested slum.
It's a perfectly nice flat. Come up and have a look.
I'm not going to like it.
You're not going up there without me.
Or me.
Please yourself. Police, make yourself decent.
Please accept my apologies, ladies, for this unwarranted display of police brutality.
I am just doing my job, Beverly.
Oh, the old jackboot excuse. Just ignore him. He won't be long.
Oh, that's a lovely bathing costume, Mrs. Ramshaw.
Oh, it's just something I threw on.
Well, leopard skin suits you.
Stop ogling my customers. You'll struggle to find anything wrong up here, Gordon.
A perfunctory glance tells me it's a death trap.
Here we go.
I can't move here, Gordon.
It'll be fine for you, Mother.
Oh, talk about double standards.
The local planning regulations are for your own protection, Beverly.
The rug's a bit soggy, Bev.
That'll soon dry out.
That didn't sound too good.
Oh, this floor isn't designed to support all that water and the heavy gym equipment. That's why it's sagging.
Rubbish.
Ladies, can you please vacate the pool and move to the side of the room, please? Make your way downstairs. Somebody's got to drain the pool.
Hey, it's taken me 2 days to fill it.
Stand back and form a human chain.
Make your mind up.
Pass me that bucket, Shirley. I'm going in.
Be careful, Gordon.
If I don't make it, tell Wendy I love her.
Oh, get on with it.
Where did all these treadmills come from?
Through that hole in the floor.
Oh, Gordon! Gordon! I'll come down to you.
I'm all right, Mother. I landed in one of the chairs.
You better not have damaged it. You and your big feet have ruined my new business.
You and your meddling's ruined my marriage, Beverly. I'll never get her back now.
No need to go bulimic at me, Gordon. You'll be hearing from my solicitor. I'm going to sue you and the police for every penny you've got.
Oh, dear, Bev, what a mess. Is this the end of Highlight?
Don't be defeatist, Shirl.
You sound like a fourth colonist.
Do I?
Oh, this isn't the end or even the beginning. It's the middle of the end. The beginning of the middle.
I'll put the kettle on, then. Chelsea, a soggy hobnob.
No, go on, then.
In Highlights, Natural Bounce, by Steve Chambers and Phil Nodding, Beverly was played by Lorraine Ashbourne and Shirley by Rosie Cavaliero. Mr. Butt was played by James Lely, Harriet by Carolyn Pickles, Nigel by Chris Pavlow, Enid by Susan Jameson, Wendy by Nicola Ferguson, Beryl by Melanie Kilburn, and Gordon by Ewan Bailey. All other parts were played by Sam Ricks, Adie Allen and Scarlett Brooks. It was directed by Liz Webb.
If you'd like to receive our newsletter with full details of the week's radio dramas, just search for BBC Radio Drama Newsletter. The Drama of the Week is a download from the BBC.
I'm on the right track. For lots of kissing, so that old greenback I won't be missing. All the greatest things in life are free. Who needs money? Not me.
I think I might start doing Botox, Shirl.
Oh, that's a good idea, Beth. You are going a bit wrinkly.
Not for me. I'm going to offer it as a new treatment. We can't go on just doing hairdressing.
I like doing hairdressing.
I'm wasted here. I never get to use the full gamut of my skills and abilities. It's like Michelangelo turning up to paint the 16th chapel and being told he's got to clean the toilets.
Are you broke again, Bev?
I have a short-term liquidity problem.
Graham suffers with that. Do your ankles swell up?
No. I need to diversificate, Shirl.
Do you? Well, can I do the Botox with you?
No, I'd like you to get involved, Shirl, but they won't allow any old clodhopper to administer a dangerous drug.
Don't needles make you feel queasy, Bev?
I'm not going to use a needle, Shirl. I'm going to spray it on.
I can do that.
You have to be medically trained.
Well, you're not.
I did my brownie first aid badge.
I thought they wouldn't let you in.
I did it online, and I've watched every episode of Embarrassing Bodies.
My Graham applied to be on that.
All right, with his ears?
No, with his feet.
I'm not wrinkly, Shirl.
You are a bit. What's the matter with my husband's ears?
Nothing if you like African elephants. Where have I got wrinkles?
Well, your forehead's quite creased.
Only when I frown.
And you've got little crow's feet around your eyes and your mouth.
They're laughter lines, Shirl.
Are they?
I'm a fun person. I'm always laughing.
I've never seen you. Well, apart from when Nigel got run over by Beryl Birkinshaw's mobility scooter.
It's subterranean with me, Shirl. I laugh inside.
I like Graham's ears. I think they're one of his best features.
They're all right if you want to hear Russian spy planes from 400 miles. Have you mopped the floor yet?
Oh, this mop's had it. I think we need a new one.
Do I look like I'm made of money?
I'm spreading more hairs than I'm picking up.
You're not doing it right, Shirl.
Oh, hello, Mr. Butt.
Hello, lady. I must apologise for my tardiness.
Good punctuation means not being late, Mr. Butts.
In pursuance of my duties delivering Her Majesty's post, I was savaged by a wild beast.
Where?
Up the Twitchell.
Oh, was it that Doberman in the bungalow?
No, it was the sausage dog next door. It went for my throat.
Did it have a stepladder?
You might have to have a tetanitis injection.
So, what is it, Mr. Butt? The usual, a trim?
Yes, thank you. But before you begin your tonsorial artistry, may I crave your indulgence?
I haven't cleaned it yet.
What?
The toilet.
No, no. Might I prevail upon you to put this road closure notice in votre fenêtre?
You what?
Can you stick this in your window?
No, I'm afraid not, Mr. Butt.
It's for the Bridgeford Trot on Friday, Beverly. The whole village is taking part.
Well, I'm not.
Everyone loves a fun run.
Anyone who thinks that running 5 miles is fun wants their head examining.
I'm doing it. I was going to ask you to sponsor me, Bev.
Well, think again.
It's for charity.
I've been doing good works all my life, Shirley, and nobody's ever given me any charity. Anyway, who's going to sponsor you?
Lots of people. I've already collected 500. I've got it in my purse, look. I'm going to jog down to the bank at lunchtime.
£500? Who are you collecting for?
The donkey sanctuary.
What's a donkey need that much money for?
Carrots!
What, £500 worth? That's a lorry load.
I'm sorry you feel so disengaged, Beverly. I was hoping to persuade you to take part in my relay team.
Bev's never been very sporty, have you?
I have. I was quite an athlete in my younger years.
I never knew that.
I would have won the Commonwealth Games if it hadn't been for my crucial ligament.
Really? I had no idea. What was your event, Beverly?
The 4,000 metres.
Don't you mean 5,000?
I know. They cut it short that year because the Russian boycott.
Russia's not in the Commonwealth.
They're in the Eurovision Song Contest.
Are they?
So's Australia.
Oh, Beverly, maybe you could help Shirl with her training if you've competed at such a high level.
Then I haven't got time for that. I've got a business to run.
Graham's in charge of my training.
What does he know about sport?
He's secretary of the darts team.
Exactly.
He's very strict. He says I've got to walk at least 5 miles a day. He gave me a barometer to wear on my wrist. It's linked to his phone.
What for?
Well, so we can see how far I'm walking when he's at work.
Let's have a look at it then, Shirl.
I'm not wearing it. It's on Curly's collar.
What? So your dog walks the 5 miles, not you?
You won't tell Graham, will you, Bev?
But I won't, Shirl. But if Curly goes after a rabbit and does 17 miles, don't come running to me.
Ladies, I do have a rather pressing engagement. Do you think we could expedite matters, please?
I'm not sure.
Well, you should have said it if you're in a hurry.
My sincere apologies, Beverly. Just do what you can in 5 minutes, please.
I'm not a sheep shearer, Mr. Butt. I'm an artiste. I've worked with the best. Mm. I've never heard anyone tell Siegfried Sassoon to hurry up and see what he could do in 5 minutes.
Perhaps I should come back later.
No. Beauty station number one, please. Sit down. Oh. Shirl, damp the dandruff down, will you?
I haven't got dandruff, Beverly.
No, of course you haven't. It's just a genial term we use for all dry skin inflictions, isn't it, Shirl?
Is it?
So what is this urgent, pressing engagement?
Oh, I'm doing a favour for my brother-in-law.
Oh, I didn't think you got on with Daz.
Oh, I don't. It wasn't my idea.
But Mrs. Butt insisted.
I have got a mind of my own, Beverly.
Of course you have. So what did she tell you to do?
Move some gym equipment from Bingthorpe Caravan Site.
The one that burnt down in superstitious circumstances?
Yes. Daz was the caretaker.
Didn't take very good care of it then, did he?
No. And I'm the one stuck with half a ton of smoke-damaged equipment in the back of my camper van. He wants me to sell it on eBay for him.
Is it badly damaged?
It's covered in soot.
Why can't he sell it?
That's what I said.
But Mrs. Butt put her foot down.
I told her I hadn't got time for all that. I'm the chair of the organising committee and the race marshal for the fun run.
Well, your wife has never been a big one for having fun, has she?
No, not really.
How much does Daz want for it, then?
He thinks it's worth a grand or more.
Fat chance. Is it even his to sell?
I don't know. All I want to do is get on with my duties. I've got to set up the water stations, collect the bibs and find a sponsor for the trophies.
Do you think our Tony could be a race marshal? He loves badges.
I'm not sure your son's got the right attributes, Shirl.
What do you need?
Common sense and the ability to tie your own shoelaces.
I'm sure Tony has a lot of good points, but marshalling requires a particular type of personality.
Like what?
Boring, self-important jobs with. Shirl, pass me the electric clippers.
Here you go, Bev.
I'll just tidy up your neck, Mr. Butt.
The annual village fun run wouldn't happen if it weren't for people like me, Beverly.
Good. Ooh. Oh, lean forward.
Everyone's talking about it, Bev. The whole village has gone fitness mad.
I'm not surprised. There's an epidemic of morbid obesity in Bridgeford. Keeping yourself trim is about self-discipline and diet. Did you get those hobnobs, Shirl?
Yes, they're on the top shelf. I better not have any. I'm in training. Well, one won't hurt. Maybe two. I'll put the kettle on.
No, leave it, Shirl. You can have your tea break during your lunch break.
Well, you've got over 100 people taking part, Beverly.
It's just a fad.
A lot of people are taking it very seriously, Bev. Lois Heber Ferdinand has had her own personal trainer.
Yeah, I bet she has.
He's called Miguel. He's from Doncaster. Enid says he's really fit.
Well, he should be if he's a personal trainer.
Enid reckons Lois is absolutely asphyxiated with him.
All I'm saying is, you don't need expensive equipment to keep yourself trim.
People are prepared to spend a great deal of money on their training programmes, Beverly.
Are they?
The global fitness industry is worth billions.
That bloke on Dragon's Teeth made a fortune from opening gyms. Oh, what's his name?
Duncan Valentine.
That's him.
I've read his autobiography.
I didn't know he was dead.
He's not. He started out with one ice cream van.
Oh, you wouldn't get much gym equipment in one of those.
No, Shirley, he made his money from ice cream and then diversified.
Do you know, I may be able to help you out.
You're going to join my relay team?
No. But I cannot stand by and watch you risk your good name and reputation.
What do you mean?
What you're doing with that gym equipment could be construed as handling stolen property.
Well, Daz assured me it was salvaged.
Well, he would, wouldn't he? The question you have to ask yourself, Mr. Butt, is why your brother-in-law asked you to set the aforementioned equipment away in an unmarked vehicle after the hours of darkness and dispose of it for him incognito.
I thought you were going to sell it on eBay.
I don't think there's anything funny going on.
Ignorance is no defence under the law.
Oh, dear.
I put it to you that just by having the evidence in your van, you are in flagrante in locus delectus.
Am I?
And ex posto facto. You won't have a leg to stand on in court.
Oh, what am I going to do, Beverly?
Well, the obvious solution is for me to take the stuff off your hands, Mr. Butts.
Oh, I couldn't let you do that.
No, don't be silly. That's what friends are for.
But what will you do with two treadmills, a rowing machine and a load of weights?
I put them in the flat upstairs. I've always fancied opening a gym.
But you just said they were a waste of time.
No. I said they're a waste of time in the hands of amateurs. With my sporting pedigree and my my knowledge of the human body, I'll be able to create a worthwhile and valuable service for the community and cash in on the fun run.
That flat upstairs is Nigel's, isn't it?
No, not really sure. Well, let's go and have a look at it. Come on, you two. Oh. We can use the connecting door.
I can't be long, Beverly. In my position, I cannot afford tardiness or laxity.
Oh, you do use a lot of long words, Mr. Butts.
Mrs. Butts has accused me of being verbose.
Well, she should talk. She could do with losing a few pounds herself.
Oh, that's harsh. It's not as if you're morbidly verbose, is it, Mr. Butts?
No.
Oh. Mind those boxes. That's valuable stock.
Oh, the scissors sticking out the sides. Oh, I'm bleeding.
Are you all right, Mr. Butts?
Don't encourage him, Shirl. It's just a scratch.
You'll have to move then, Beverly. Health and safety.
Oh, here we go. The pedant's revolt strikes again. Right. Highlights Fitness Suite and Wellness Spa.
Oh.
What do you think?
Ooh, well, it's a bit pokey.
It's a bit dusty.
It's perfect. I'll put the treadmills over there. The rowing machine is by the toilet and the weights can be where that camp bed is. We can charge them as they come into the salon and we send them upstairs.
Unsupervised?
No, I'll have CCTV. Make sure they don't nick anything.
The apparatus is very dirty, Beverly, from the fire.
Cheryl can clean it.
Well, if I've got a new mop, Bev, where's the spa going to be?
The bathroom, obviously.
Can I look after the treadmill? Graham says I need more amoebic exercise.
No, you're in charge of rowing, Cheryl.
I can't swim.
What about Nigel?
Oh, yeah, he's a good swimmer. He used to be a lifeguard at the leisure centre.
No, you'll have to consult him about the gym. It's his flat.
Which he lent to me.
When you told him you were homeless.
I nearly was. Technically, I am still a sitting tenant.
So, are you actually paying rent?
No, it's a lousy flat.
So what makes you think it'll be suitable as a gymnasium?
Horses for courses, Mr. Butts.
I don't think you'll be allowed animals, Bev, especially upstairs.
Nigel's flat might not be great to live in, but it'll make an ideal bijou gym. Intimate, with a retro ambience that makes clients feel energised and empowered.
It's not much ventilation.
Exactly. It'll make them sweat like pigs. It'll be like that hot wigwam yoga. Come on, we better go back downstairs.
You'll have to pay Nigel some rent if you're using it as a business premises.
Well, obviously. Want to start making money.
I'll need the money up front, Beverly.
What money?
For the gym equipment.
I'm doing you a favour. Taking all that heavy stuff out of your camper van. I thought you'd want to donate it.
Why would I do that?
Because you're the race marshal and always blathering on about the fun run and the good of the village.
Well, yes, but...
Well, you prefer to stop people getting fit and turning their lives around. People could die because of your avarice.
That's not fair.
No, I tell you what's not fair. It's you taking the credit for organising the charity fund run while your family make a profit out of it at the same time.
But you're going to charge them, Beverly.
A token amount. Plus a joining fee.
Well, isn't that excessive?
No, we need to get the money up front. Time is of the effluence. Strike while the iron's hot.
The thing is, Beverly, I've promised Mrs. Butt I'll get some money for her brother.
But it's not even his to sell.
And now he's lost his job.
Because of his own incontinence, Mr. Butt.
Really?
Well, that's as maybe. But I can't go back to Mrs. Butt empty-handed. If you were to buy that stuff new, it would cost you nearly £8,000.
Okay. I'll give you £250.
I couldn't take a penny less than £750.
£500?
Done.
Great. I'll pay you next month.
Oh, no. I must have the cash now.
Bev hasn't got any money. She's got a water retention problem.
What?
Right, go and get your coat, Mr. Butt. Shirl, come over by the toilet. I need a word.
I did the best I could with that mop, Bev.
No, it's not about that, Shirl. I need the donkey money. I'm thinking of your Tony.
Really?
Well, I was going to give him the chance to get in on my new fitness venture on the ground floor.
I thought it was upstairs.
Look, give me the 500, Shirl, and your Tony can have a job. After all, he hasn't worked since the sewage farm pulled the plug on him.
It wasn't his fault. Those valves all look the same.
Tell that to the 3,000 people who got food poisoning.
Oh, it did knock his confidence. Oh, all right, then. Here you are.
It's all here.
Yes. I will get it back, won't I?
Have I ever let you down, Cheryl?
Well...
Exactly. Right, here you go, Mr. Butt. Oh. 500 smackers.
Oh, right. Well, I must be going. I'll drop it all off in the morning. Bye.
Bye. Right, get yourself upstairs then, Cheryl.
What for?
The flat needs a good clean before the apparatus arrives.
Bev, I said I'd leave a donkey deposit at the bank tomorrow.
The donkeys don't know what day it is, Shirl. It's only a loan. I'm going to invest it for them.
But I promised the vicar she's the treasurer of the donkey sanctuary. She won't be happy.
If she tries to create dysentery in the ranks, I'll tell you you've donated it to a more deserving charity.
Well, Highlights isn't a charity, is it?
Well, it's as good as. If we don't succeed, Shirl, we run the risk of failure.
Gonna build a big fence around my baby. Oh yeah.
Oh yeah.
Build a big fence around my baby. Oh yeah.
Oh yeah.
I like everything that you do.
Oh. They're making a lot of noise up there, Bev. I can't concentrate.
So what's new, Shirl? How difficult is it to exfoliate 6 hairbrushes?
I'm just trying to get the hair out of them. Oh, dear. It sounds like they're going to come through the ceiling.
They're making a meal and moving a few bits of gym equipment.
That rear entrance is a bit tight. Mr. Buck was struggling to hold up his end.
I thought his layabout brother-in-law was helping him.
Das? Yes, he seems to be doing all the work. Maybe I should take him a drink.
Just in case he takes his top off?
No. Mind he is very muscly.
If you like that kind of thing, Shirl. I prefer my men to be a bit more at market.
Like Richard Gere?
Oh, no, he's too full of himself. Look at me with the Dalai Lama on top of some Tahitian mountain.
Oh! That sounded like Dad. Oh, hope he's all right.
You know, he better not have damaged my equipment. He was always a bit heavy-handed.
Didn't you go out with him?
No, Shirl. Well, he asked me out, of course, but I knocked him back.
I thought he dumped you at the ice rink.
No, I don't think so.
You should never have told him that you were the British figure skating champion.
Right, what have we got in the book this morning?
We got a perm and a root retouch. We did have a couple of extensions, but they've changed their minds. They want it cut short for the fun run to be more hero-demonic.
You know, I knew that charity event would end up costing me money.
Oh, I haven't thought of that, Ben.
On the other hand, my new gym upstairs should make a tidy profit. Swings and roundabouts, show.
Are we having those as well?
Once they've got all the equipment into the flat, I want you to clean it. You can do it in your lunch hour.
I promised Graham I'd go for a jog at lunchtime. He's not very happy with me, or the dog.
Why?
He popped home yesterday to walk Curly and found my pedal meter on his tail.
Oh, dear. Well, you can jog on the spot while you're cleaning, and then I'll let you use the rowing machine.
For free?
No, you'll get a staff discount.
How much do I get off?
10%.
10%?
No, you're right, Shirl, you're right. Too generous. Make it 5. Now, come on, hurry up. Harriet's due in any minute now. She texted me first thing.
What's the vicar one?
A haircut.
Well, what if she asks me about the money I've raised from the fun run for the donkey sanctuary? She's the treasurer.
Tell her you've invested it in a high-yield adventure capital scheme.
I thought I'd lent it to you to buy the gym equipment.
You have. You don't have to tell her that.
Oh, I couldn't lie to her, Vicar Bev. It's 7 years bad luck.
Well, you've had 25 years bad luck being married to Graham. How much worse can it get?
Graham's lovely. Anyway, I get hiccups if I lie.
You don't have to lie, Shirl. Just don't tell Harriet the truth. Politicians do it all the time.
Do they?
Answer a question with the answer to another question. Look. Right, ask me what I'm doing tonight.
I thought you were going to the pictures.
Just ask me.
What are you doing tonight, Bev?
That's a very good question, but I'm more concerned about the plight of the homeless and the lack of cohesion in our community.
So you're not going to the pictures?
No. That was just an example of how to avoid a tricky question. Don't you get it?
Not really, Bev.
Oh, you'll just have to prevaricate.
I think I'll just waffle. Oh, what are they doing now?
They're fixing the treadmill to the floor.
So no one nicks it?
No, to stop it falling over if it's overloaded. Is Fat Rob doing the fun run?
Yes, he's collecting for the Vegetable Society.
But he runs a burger bar.
He wants to put something back. He's doing it in costume.
As a vegetable?
No, as a gorilla.
How will anyone tell the difference? Keep the noise down, will you? There's an artiste working down here.
Is there?
Yes, me. Do you think Beethoven could have composed the Nutcracker Suite with that racket going on?
Wasn't he deaf?
Oh, that's besides the point. All my customers are complaining!
All right!
Oh, that's better.
Workmen are like children. They need to know where they stand.
Oh, I could never be forceful like you, Bev.
Leadership's a lonely 4-0, Shirl. Do you think I like being nasty?
Well,
It's like training a dog. Once you show them who's boss, they do as they're told.
Oh,
bloody hell! Sorry, Vicar.
Morning, ladies. Don't worry, Beverly, I've heard worse. My first parish was in the East End of Glasgow.
Oh, sit yourself down in the wee chair, Minister. How are things at the Kirk?
Are you all right, Bev?
Yes, Shirl. Have you never heard of a Scottish accent before?
A laudable attempt at the vernacular.
We went on one of those when we went to the Isle of Man.
I beg your pardon?
It was ever so steep. Our Tonys always love railways.
I think you mean funicular, Shirley.
No, it was definitely the Isle of Man.
Right, Shirley, I'll take a worship till this to beauty station number 3.
Sit down over here, Harriet.
Thank you, Shirley.
So what's it to be, Vicar?
Well, I'd like it short and streamlined, please.
Oh, yeah, like the rest of the gabardine swine.
I beg your pardon?
There you go, following the crowd.
Probably will be, Beverly. I'm afraid that my training isn't going as well as I'd hoped.
Oh, me neither.
I planned to run 5 miles a day last week, but Mr. Slackbottom's funeral rather derailed my schedule.
Oh, how inconsiderate of him to keel over and die at short notice.
I didn't mean it like that, Beverly.
I'm sure if he'd known it was so important to you, he'd have postponed it till after the race.
Wasn't he run over by the mobile library?
Damper a minute's down, Shirl.
All right.
I don't think you're being fair, Beverly.
Don't talk to me about fair. This fun run's decimalised my business. Cheap hairdos and parking cones everywhere.
It is for a good cause. We're collecting lots of money, aren't we, Shirley?
Yes.
Well, as long as there's enough in the pot to cover my compensation claim for lost business. Pass me the scissors, Shirley.
What on earth is that? Is Nigel having some work done upstairs?
No, it's Bev's new apparatuses.
What apparatus?
She's opening a gym.
In Nigel's flat?
No, technically, it's my flat, Harriet. I'm a sitting tenant. Put your head back.
When are you opening?
Tomorrow.
Can't be very big. What kind of gym is it?
Very exclusive. We've already had to turn people down.
Have we?
We'll be offering a whole range of fitness programmes and spa treatments.
I'm in charge of the rowing. You don't even have to be able to swim.
You won't be doing dance classes, will you?
Oh, yes. Yeah, if that's what my public demands.
Oh, dear. I hope you're not going to lure people away from my Christian Zumba sessions.
You shouldn't be offering that anyway.
Why on earth not?
Well, it's a contradiction in terms, isn't it? Mixing devil worship with Christianity.
Devil worship?
Well, it's voodoo, isn't it? Zumba.
It's a Colombian dance and fitness craze.
You know, for a practicing minister of the church, you are very naive, Harriet.
My divinity doctorate focused on pagan rituals.
Well, you should have paid a bit more attention then. Have you never seen Live and Let Die?
No.
Oh, that's Graham's favourite film. He's always modelled himself on Roger Moore.
Don't you mean Dudley Moore?
My Zumba classes are innocent fun. Voodoo arose from a set of spiritual folkways that developed from the traditions of the African diaspora.
Obviously, Harriet. Any fool knows that.
I didn't.
What they don't tell you is that all these South American cavortins are rooted in Satanism.
Like what?
But the rumba, the samba, the pasodoble, all of them are about wanton desire and lewdity.
Even the hokey-cokey.
Well, my Zumba class helps raise money for the church roof.
Surely, you've got more important spiritual and moral matters to attend to. You really shouldn't be meddling in something you don't understand. Leave it to the professionals.
Won't the gym be rather noisy for your clients in the salon?
Don't worry, Harriet. We're having the whole of upstairs professionally soundproofed.
Are we?
Yeah, there's a bespoke acoustic carpeted surface being laid this afternoon.
What is it, Bev?
That rug that Enid found in a shed.
I hear you've done extremely well with your collection for the donkey sanctuary, Shirley.
Who told you that?
You did, yesterday, on the phone.
Oh.
I thought you were going to pay the money in at the post office, but Mr. Butt said you hadn't been in.
I've been busy.
Have you got the money with you?
Sort of.
You all right, Shirley?
Yes, fine, thank you.
I told you not to offer Eccles cake, Shirl. Do you like cakes, Vicar?
Well, I've forsworn them until after the fun run.
Me too.
So where is the £500, Shirley?
What?
The charity money.
That's a good question, but I'm more concerned with the flight of the hopeless and the lack of confusion in our community.
What?
Get off your soapbox, you'll ignore her, Vicar. She's always spouting politics to the clients, aren't you, Shirl?
Yes.
You can give me the 500, Shirley. I'll put it in the post office for you.
Shut your mouth, Harriet.
I beg your pardon?
I'm doing your fringe. I don't want you to swallow any hairs.
Oh, of course.
Shirl, get yourself upstairs and tell Daz and Mr. Butt to keep the noise down.
Now?
Yes. Go on. Is that enough off your fringe, Harriet?
Yes, I think so, Beverly.
Do you want me to do anything about the moustache?
I haven't got a moustache, have I?
Well, it looks worse in this light.
I had no idea.
No, I wouldn't worry about it, Harriet. Most average women of your age suffer with it.
I'm only 38.
Really? Oh. Well, I mean, although I've found that being beautiful can be a curse.
How?
Well, I've never had to try as hard as others.
No one's mentioned my facial hair before.
Well, they wouldn't, would they? And looks aren't really a requirement in your job. In fact, it's probably a bonus being a bit plain. Helps if you're trying to stay celibate.
I'm not a nun, Beverly. I have had relationships with men.
Not for a while, Harriet.
No. Would you advise me to depilate, then?
What you do in the privacy of your own home is your affair, Vicar. Just do the hairs on the back of your neck with the clippers. Lean forward, please.
Oh!
And keep still. Oh. If you want to get a bloat, you could start by losing a few pounds.
That's why I'm in training for the fun run.
Ah, that's short term. To tone up properly and get in trim, you need to join a gym and have a few spa treatments.
I'm not sure, Beverly.
Look, only a real friend like me would have the courage to tell you you're flabby and unappealing.
Oh, thanks.
Think nothing of it. If you sign up today, I can let you have platinum corporate membership at a specially reduced annual rate.
Oh, I've never been one for gyms. I hate being tied to a contract.
You've obviously got a deep-rooted problem with commitment.
I haven't. I am committed to my faith and the church.
Well, we could all say that, Harriet.
You couldn't, Beverly. We'd never see you in church.
Some of us find more private, less showy ways of communing with our Maker.
You told me you were an atheist.
I am. Doesn't mean I don't believe in God.
I think you find it does.
Well, that's you done, Harriet. I'm rather proud of that, given the raw material. Although short hair exposes too much of your face.
I'm taking part in the fun run, not entering a beauty contest, Beverly.
Just as well. Have you ever given anything a real go, Harriet?
Of course I have. I've preached all over the world.
I moved on every time the going's got tough. It's no wonder your parishioners don't have any faith in you.
Who doesn't?
Enid, Lois, Beryl Birkinshaw and a few others who shall also remain nameless told me in confidence. Joining Highlight's fitness programme stacks up. It'll show you're not stuck up and you've got sticking power and you're not a stick in the mud.
Will it?
I'm willing to design a personal wellness programme to your specific needs. Mm. What would you like to do?
Well, there is one thing I've always fancied having a go at, but you won't do it.
Try me, Harriet.
I've always had a yen for taekwondo.
We do that. What is it?
Korean kickboxing.
Yeah, we definitely do that. Well, a version.
Oh, how interesting. You do your own form.
Yeah, it's a mixture of Tai Chi and Kung Fu. Oh. It's called Taifu. Yeah. Shall I put the kettle on?
If you've got a properly qualified instructor, I'll sign up.
Well, of course we have.
What, Dan?
No, he's called Tony. He's learnt from the very best.
In the Far East?
Yes, Norwich, I think.
What on earth is that?
Shirl's mobile.
Shirl! Phone! It's Graham.
Coming! Answer it, will you, Beth?
Hello, Graham. No, she's upstairs with Daz. I don't know what they're getting up to, but they've been doing it for ages.
Graham, is everything all right? Oh, no, Bev told me to keep an eye on him, that's all. Nothing! Oh, I don't fancy him. No, I haven't had a chance to do my exercises, but I'm going to have a row at lunchtime. No, not on the canal in Bev's new gym. Yes, upstairs in Nigel's flat. Oh, are you sure? Beryl, when?
Sure, give me that. Graham... Unless you're ringing up for a haircut, I suggest you talk to your wife outside working hours. Goodbye.
Bev.
No need to thank me, Shirl. What did he want?
He said he'd ring up at lunchtime to make sure I was doing my exercises.
It's only 11 o'clock.
Well, that's when Graham has his first lunch.
What about his 11s?
He has those at 9.
So when does he have his second lunch?
That's a bit of a manoeuvrable feast.
Well, I must be going. How much do I owe you?
200 for the gym membership and 40 for the haircut. Let's just call it 250, shall we?
I'll have to write a cheque out then.
Oh, that's fine. Shirl, what was Graham saying about Beryl?
Oh, yeah. Apparently, Beryl Birkinshaw is moving into Nigel's flat next week.
She can't. What about me, Jim?
Maybe I'll leave the membership for the moment, Beverly.
No, I'll sort it out, Harriet.
There's the £40. I'll get the £500 off you after the run on Friday, Shirl.
Absolutely.
Bye.
Bye.
Oh, what did you tell her that for?
You asked me. Oh, what am I going to do about the donkey money if Nigel kicks you out?
That won't happen, Shirl. As Napoleon said at the gates of Stalingrad, je ne regrette rien.
Oh, what does that mean?
They shall not pass. Well, when they say, go marching in. Well, when they say, go marching in. Oh, Lord, I want to be in that number.
I was born the running kind, with leaving always on my mind.
Good morning, Highlights Beauty Salon and Wellness Spa. Oh, hello, Margaret. Yes, you're booked in at 3. Why not come at 2 and give kickboxing a try? You can leave your mobility scooter around the back. Oh, please yourself, then.
Oh, Beth.
I'm exhausted. Oh, I ran all the way from the post office.
No, you didn't, Cheryl. I watched you. You had a sit down in the bus shelter.
I had to. I almost dropped the wagon wheels.
So much for your diet.
Shall I put the kettle on?
No, we haven't got time. Nigel's due in 5 minutes.
To use the new gym upstairs?
Not for a haircut. Whatever you do, don't mention the gym.
It is his flat, Bev.
I'm the sitting tenant. I don't know what possessed you to sign up for that fun run.
I did it for the donkey sanctuary, Bev. I'm up to 3 minutes now. 5 minutes can't be that difficult.
What's 5 minutes got to do with
it? That's how long I've got to run for.
5K don't mean 5 minutes, Shirl. It means 5 kilometres.
How long will that take me?
About a week.
Oh.
Even Lionel Christie can't run 5 kilometres in 5 minutes.
Oh.
Hang on, Shirl.
Careful how you pop those weights down. If they come through the ceiling and hit me, on your head be it.
What if I can't finish the fun run?
The donkeys will starve.
Oh, I'll have to do it then. But I gave you all the money I collected for your gym.
You'll get it back, Shirl. I've taken 3 memberships over the phone this morning.
Can I have the 500 quid back then?
Oh, if only it were that simple. It's now part of my investment portmanteau. By investing in the gym, you're helping me, you're helping the village, and you're helping the donkeys.
How?
Well, the partners in the gym, aren't they?
Will they get gym membership?
No, the sleeping partners. Mind, that's all they do. Lie around all day. I don't know why you're so bothered about them.
They've been rescued from all over Europe, Bev.
So we're letting foreign donkeys come over here to lie about and eat English grass?
They've all been neglected.
So have I. No one set up a sanctuary for me.
I've adopted an Albanian ass called Attila. Curly loves him.
I'm not surprised. It'll smell just like his dog food.
Do you know the difference between an ass and a donkey, Bev?
Oh, everyone knows that.
What is it, then?
Oh, I haven't got time to explain it in laywoman's terms, Cheryl.
Good morning, ladies.
Oh, hello, Nigel. Do you know the difference between an ass and a donkey?
Well, yes, all donkeys are asses, but not all asses are donkeys.
Nah, if only it were that simple, Nigel.
Oh, shh. What's that, Beverly?
Mice.
In my flat?
Well, you shouldn't have been so penny-pinching with the maintenance.
What about mules?
That's just another name for a donkey.
No, that's not correct, Beverly.
Oh, pardon me. I thought you were a butcher, not a vet.
I do know a little about animals.
Yeah, about killing them and chopping them up.
A mule is the sterile progeny of a male donkey and a female horse.
Ignore him, Shirl. He's making it up as he goes along.
I am not.
Ooh, you are being forceful this morning, Nigel.
Stroppy, I'd call it.
Actually, it's the new me. I'm demonstrating my self-confidence and independence.
On your own?
I've just completed my assertiveness course.
Oh, Curly did one of those.
That was an obedience class, Cheryl. Fat lot of good it did.
That sausage dog taunted him.
So, why are you doing it, Nigel?
If you must know, Lois put my name forward to be a JP.
You?
Why not me?
I think it's nice. What kind of music are you going to play?
No, Cheryl. JP means Justice of the Peace.
Oh!
Yeah. Now, Beverly, while I'm here, I want to go upstairs to my flat and see what's going on.
Nothing's going on. But I don't want to be rude, Nigel, but surely you're too soft, indecisive and ineffectual to be a magistrate.
Yeah, that's why I've been on my course.
Assertiveness isn't something you can learn out of books, Nigel. It's in your genes.
I beg to differ, Beverly.
I don't think it's in mine, and I wear them a lot.
Beg all you want, Nigel, you're still wrong. Sit in that chair and let me cut your hair.
Thank you, but no, I've changed my mind. I don't want a haircut.
Oh, gratin, Nigel. You can't be upstanding, sitting on the bench, sending people down, looking like cat weasel.
One of my core learning outcomes is not caring what other people think about me.
Well, even if you look like a pot-sniffing hippie.
I don't look, do I?
Sit in the chair, Nigel.
All right, then. Just a short trip. Do I really look like a hippie?
Oh, your hair's terribly greasy.
Well, I washed it yesterday.
In butter?
I've given up butter, except on sandwiches or toast or in cakes. Or scones.
Give me the spray, Cheryl. Nigel, lean back and keep your eyes and mouth closed.
That definitely isn't mice.
Probably rats, then. So, Nigel, what on earth possessed you to want to become a JP?
Well, I've been thinking about it for a while, and I'd like to put something back, Beverly. Make a real difference to people's lives.
By locking them up and making them homeless?
No.
I agree. Most of them deserve it, if not worse.
I believe in rehabilitation, giving people a second chance.
I wouldn't give them a first chance. Some of them should be locked up at birth.
That's a very negative view of society, Beverly.
Learnt in the School of Hard Knocks. You'll have to change your name.
Why?
Well, there's a lot of nasty people out there who'll be after you. Do you think Judge John Deed is really called John Deed?
Oh, no.
is Martin Bodie.
And I wouldn't be happy with some investigator poring over all my most intimate details.
I've got nothing to hide, Beverly.
As long as you've never had a speeding ticket or looked at a dodgy website, you'll be fine.
They won't do that, will they?
They'll trawl a comb through every detail of your personal life, interview your previous lovers.
Oh.
No, don't worry. I won't tell them anything.
Well, there's nothing to tell.
Well, that's the line I'll be giving him. Put me down as a character reference.
No, that's very kind, but...
Well, Shirl will be a referee too, won't you, Shirl?
What?
You'll be a referee.
Oh, I don't know anything about football.
Look, someone told me that they'd seen heavy equipment being moved into my flat yesterday.
Who told you?
Are you or are you not running a gym in my flat?
I've never heard anything so ridiculous in all my life. Whoever said that is a liar and a charmeleon.
Well, Harriet's the most honest person I've ever met.
The vicar. I might have known.
So you are running a gym?
No! 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 Absolutely not.
Okay, that is coming from our flat. It sounds like a dance class.
No, it's kickboxing.
Shirl, shut that door.
You lied to me, Beverly. You swore that you were not running a gym.
I'm not. It's a wellness spa.
Isn't that just semantics?
That doesn't start until six.
Are you in on this as well, Shirley?
Well, of course she is, Nigel.
It was a joint decision. I just went along with it.
Oh, this is ridiculous. I'm going up there to have a look.
I haven't finished your hair yet, Nigel. Hold him down, Shirl.
Oh.
Look, it's my flat and you're running an illicit business in it.
How dare you? My businesses are totally illicit.
You've taken advantage of my good nature for the last time. I let you have my flat when you told me you were homeless.
I was.
You were just having your bedroom decorated.
Oh, I didn't realise I was dealing with the Stasi. You'll be ordering me to wear an ankle tag next.
That Rob had one of those. Reckoned if he put it in the microwave, the police couldn't track him.
Did it work?
Yeah, but we didn't get very far. The microwave had one of those short leads. It only stretched as far as the pantry.
The fact remains that the flat belongs to me. This isn't personal, Beverly.
How can anything between us not be personal, Nigel, given our history? Can you forget the passions of the past so easily?
It's true I had feelings for you, Beverly, but you made it crystal clear that you didn't reciprocate.
When?
At the National Transport Enthusiasts Convention. You called me the most boring, dozy dullard you'd ever met, and you never wanted to see me again.
You've never understood women, Nigel. That was just a lover's tiff.
Ah.
Lovers. We never even kissed.
Oh, you never gave it time. It was all sex with you, isn't it?
Chance would be a fine thing. I've had the shop next door for 7 years. At the start, I used to have my hair cut 3 times a week just to see you. I brought you chocolates, flowers...
And tripe.
And they say romance is dead.
No, it wasn't just tripe. It was black pudding and sausages and other high-quality meat products. But you always knocked me back,
right,
Beverly.
So this is revenge then, Nigel?
No. I don't have your sang-froid.
No, probably not.
Who's got it then?
This hasn't got anything to do with you and me, Beverly. I didn't even know you were still using the flat.
Apology accepted, Nigel. As long as this isn't a ploy, it's getting under the radar on the ground floor of the upstairs gym.
No, the gym has to go. I've promised the flat to Beryl Birkinshaw as a favour to Gordon. She's moving in at the weekend.
Oh, talk about local corruption.
What do you mean?
I bet you wouldn't have been so keen to help his mother if Gordon wasn't the local bobby. Rubbing shoulders with your bosom buddies in the police while you scratch their backs behind my back. You've got some front.
That is an outrageous slander.
No, I tell you what's outrageous. All your secret Masonic Club Rotary Lodge societies with your funny handshakes and secret whistles and winks.
I'm not a member of any secret society.
Well, what about the one we went to? Hat badges, little black box and funny names.
The East Midlands Transport Enthusiasts Association is hardly a secret society.
There were some very strange people there. Police Sergeant Gordon Birkinshaw being one of them.
Gordon was only there as security after what happened in 95.
What did happen?
The Worksop branch gate crashed the plenary when we were debating coach liveries. It got very messy very quickly.
Graham's mum came from Worksop.
Yeah, they're a nasty bunch. lean forward, Nigel, while I do your neck.
Letting my flat to Beryl Birkinshaw is purely business, Beverly.
Can I remind you that I'm a tenant sitting under the law?
You've never paid any rent.
Yes, it was a right tip. Boxes everywhere.
They were yours. You were using it as a storeroom.
Well, I think it's outrageous that you're prepared to dump on your mates so you can get special favours.
Like what?
Well, there aren't any traffic cones in front of your shop, are there?
There's a double yellow line, Beverly.
Which you will be able to park on with gay abandon now. Nobody's going to give you a ticket when the policeman's mother's living in your flat.
What are they doing up there?
Oh. I did not. Don't be ridiculous. Okay, fine. Just go. Go.
I want my money back, Beverly.
No refunds, Enid. What's happened to your nose?
Your useless son kicked me in the face.
Oh, I'm sure he didn't mean to.
You must have got in the way.
Trained instructor. My backside. Your Tony knows as much about Korean boxing as I know about breeding chinchillas.
Right, I'm going to have a look at my flat.
No!
Come back!
Oh, yes.
Brilliant. Why didn't you stop him, Shirl?
I don't know.
I've been badly injured doing one of your classes, Beverly. I'm going to sue you.
You can't. You signed a form devoiding yourself of reliability, Enid. Besides, there's nothing wrong with you.
I might need plastic surgery.
You've always needed plastic surgery. Anyway, you'll have to sue Nigel. He's the landlord. I'm just the lowly downtrodden tenant.
We had a chinchilla once.
What?
It escaped and lived under the floorboards. It survived by eating Graham's socks. Well, I say survived. It didn't last very long.
Beverly! Beverly! This has to stop now!
We haven't got started yet.
There's 2 tons of gym equipment and a paddling pool. Have you had that floor testing?
Of course I have.
She got Fat Rob to jump up and down for an hour.
An hour?
Well, he got tired after 10 minutes.
I'm extremely worried about your unlicensed and unregulated gym injuring friends of mine.
Neither of your friends are members. It's typical. Shutting down a community initiative for charity.
You charged me, Beverly.
I have to cover my overheads, Enid.
Well, everyone wants their membership money back.
What about the donkeys?
You've signed up donkeys?
Beth says they're only sleepy partners.
Hand it over, Beverly.
You should know, Enid, that renegading on your responsibilities will have dire consequences.
Like what?
The needless slaughter of dozens of defenceless dumb animals.
Oh, no, please, Enid, don't kill the donkeys. Give it another try.
Yeah, forget kickboxing. Try something else.
Oh, well, I'm not sure. What other martial arts do you do?
Shirl, is your Tony any good at fencing?
Yeah, he painted next doors last weekend, 2 coats.
Enid, how about weightlifting? You've always had a lovely figure. Tone up.
Oh, I might give it a try. Have you got any of those dodgy tablets that all the athletes take?
Anabolic steroids. They're meant to be really bad for you.
Oh, they give you a nasty temper.
Well, you must have eaten a hatful, Beverly. I didn't want to do taekwondo. I was promised aquazumba.
I know, but that starts next week when we've repaired the paddling pool.
Well, your Tony had better not be taking it, Shirley.
Oh, no, he can't swim.
I must say, Beverly, I'm very unhappy about water-based activities being conducted in my flat. I'll have to turn the water off.
Are we living in Victoria times? Have you never read the Magna Carta? We hold these truths to be evidently right, that all men are equal and have the right to a bath or a shower.
No, I'm going to call the parish council, organise a proper health and safety inspection and close you down.
Over my dead body. I've done my own inspection and there's nothing wrong with it.
Forgive me if I don't have confidence in your appraisal. Good day, I must run.
Bye, Nigel.
But if you break your leg, don't come running back to me.
If you train yourself to fit the world, there won't be nothing left. Just a little here and a little there. Do you all know yourself? Run, 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 run to the city of refuge. You better run. Run, 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 run to the city of refuge. You better run.
You better run.
Run. Shirl, we're about to open. Tell me we're down here.
Do I have to?
Right, that treadmill is for bona fide gym members. I'll have to dot your wages.
I thought it was a 15-minute free trial, Bev.
Well, not when you're supposed to be working in the salon.
Oh, jiggered. They only had 200 to go.
How far have you run?
50.
50 metres?
I did burn off 7 calories.
Well, you were eating when you went up the stairs.
That was an energy bar.
It was a Mars bar. You lost 7 calories and put on a couple of hundred.
I'm pacing myself.
The fun runs tomorrow, Shirl.
Oh, hello, Mr. Bott. You're a bit early for the post.
My current preoccupation is somewhat more pressing than being the purveyor of the post, Shirley.
Have you delivered those promotional leaflets about my new gym yet?
I don't think it's a good idea, Beverly.
That's why you're a run-of-the-mill postmaster and I'm a visionary businesswoman. See, once the word gets out, I'll be flooded with new members.
That's what I'm worried about. You've got to get rid of the gym equipment. Daz had no right to sell it.
Possession is 12/5 of the law, Mr. Butt. Considering it was fire damaged, I paid your worthless brother-in-law good money for the apparatus.
The insurance company is investigating the conflagration of the caravan site.
I thought it burnt down.
That's Daz's problem. He's the caretaker.
The police are after him. He's done a runner.
Why?
They think it was arson. We've got to get rid of the evidence, Beverly.
No, I'm not giving it back. I mean, technically, it's not my responsibility.
The sale was transacted between you and Daz, Beverly. You're the proprietor.
No, that's where you're wrong. The equipment belongs to Shirley. She paid for it, didn't you, Shirl?
I only lent you the money, Bev.
That was adventure capital. You bejazzled the 500 quid from the donkey sanctuary.
I told Harriet I'd give her the collection money tomorrow.
You shouldn't make promises you can't keep, Shirl.
You promised I'd get it back.
Look, Beverly, I can't afford to jeopardise my reputation by being caught up in a scandal. I insist that you divest yourself of that gymnasia paraphernalia.
Now, my fitness emporium is doing really well. I've got women queuing up to join me classes.
Can I have my money back, then?
No. But, Mr. Butt, if you're that worried, I'll cut my own throat and sell it all back to you for £2,000.
You'll pay £500. But we need to get rid of it all so that when we're questioned by the police, we have credible deniability.
Ah, right, I see. Do you think you could deny something incredibly to the police, Shirl?
No.
Oh, no.
Oh, I'm sorry.
No, no, a police car's just pulled up.
It's Wendy. What do I say if she questions me?
Nothing.
Morning, Beverly. Shirley. Hello, Mr. Butt.
I love donkeys, Wendy. I wouldn't ever take advantage of them, and if they had any money, I don't think they'd mind if I borrowed it, if they knew I was helping them, even if I didn't, straight away. I'd never do anything to hurt dumb animals or even clever ones.
I'm sorry, Shirley. You've lost me.
Ignore her, Wendy. She's seen too many wildlife documentaries. She's obsessed with grilled bears.
Well, I must be going.
Wait a minute, Mr. Butt. I wanted a word.
Oh, I haven't got time now, Wendy. I've got important post office business to attend to. The populace of Bridgeford depend on my moral rectitude.
This is quite important.
I would be sorely missed if I was unable to prosecute my responsibilities as a citizen and postmaster.
And race marshal.
All right. I'll pop in this afternoon.
I'm closing early. Bye then.
Oh, I only wanted to talk to him about road closures for the race.
So what can I do for you today then, Wendy? Washing a trim?
No, I haven't come for a hairdo.
Oh, no. Have you come to arrest me?
Very funny, Shirley. I've come to look at the gym.
Oh, well, you're in luck. We're still accepting new members. We have a special discount for the emergency services.
Actually, Beverly, I've been ordered here by Gordon and the parish council. Nigel's made a complaint about the business you run in his flat upstairs.
Oh, I might have known. Hell hath no fury like a butcher's scorn.
What do you mean?
Nigel always gets vindictive whenever I spurn his amphibious advances. He tries to ruin things for me.
That doesn't sound like
He's a classic example of an antisocial psychopath. He's got all the symptoms.
What? A pervasive pattern of disregard for the safety of others?
He's in the St. John's ambulance.
I've never thought of him as deceitful and manipulative with a disregard for the law.
He's got a deep-rooted psychic disorder. He kills animals for a living.
He's a butcher. I don't think he actually kills them, Beverly.
Well, he chops them up. Nigel's so full of anger and bitterness. Mine is not the only one, is he, Shirl?
No, lots of people have it in for you.
I didn't realise you'd trained in psychology, Beverly.
Well, I don't practice anymore. Well, obviously, my expertise comes into play through hairdressing. People feel a need to share with me. Don't they, Shirl?
Oh, yeah. You always wheedle it out of them in the end.
Nigel's worried that his flat won't hold a lot of people and heavy equipment. If I could just take a quick look upstairs...
No, I don't think so. Everyone knows you've got an invested interest in moving your mother-in-law into Nigel's flat.
I resent that. Beryl can live with me and Gordon as long as she wants.
Oh, come on, Wendy. We all know how difficult Beryl Birkinshaw can be.
Gordon says it's not her fault. She's in a lot of pain.
Is she still suffering with that trapped psychotic nerve?
It seems to come and go without warning.
Yeah, funny how she always develops mysterious exotic symptoms when you and Gordon are about to jet off somewhere.
Yeah, or even just a night out.
What was it forced you to cancel the trip to San Francisco and Alcatraz?
Suspected dengue fever.
Yeah, not bad for someone who's never been further than Mablethorpe.
Beryl was worried she might have contracted it from a friend who went to Knowsley Safari Park.
And had she?
No. She turned the central heating up too high.
Oh, that was lucky.
Oh, Gordon was devastated.
Because of the heating bill?
No, about missing Alcatraz.
Oh, yeah, he loves his prisons, doesn't he?
Next year he's promised to take me to Devil's Island.
Me and Graham went there.
Where? South America?
No, Northumberland. But I don't remember seeing any prisons there.
I think you mean Holy Island, Shirl.
Oh, yeah.
Look, Beverly, the sooner you let me look at the gym, the sooner I'll be out of your hair.
Shouldn't you be out catching criminals instead of harassing innocent fitness gurus?
If only. Gordon pulled me off the fire.
Oh.
No, the one at the caravan site. I was the one who worked out it was arson. Gordon thought it was an accident.
Well, maybe it was.
No, I spent 3 hours on my hands and knees sifting through the ashes.
Oh, look at your nails, they're ruined.
I found a tin of lighter fuel close to where the fire started.
Well, it could have been kids. I've had a crafty fag.
That's what Gordon said. But when I went to talk to the caretaker, he did a runner.
Well, that doesn't prove anything. Daz was probably training for the fun run.
In his work boots. He didn't come back. And we found £500 in his caravan.
Oh, no.
The blaze could have been caused by lightning.
It was a clear night, Beverly.
Perfect conditions for spontaneous combustion, then.
I doubt it. Anyway, it's not up to me anymore. As soon as Gordon realised it was a proper case, he took over.
Typical Gordon, hogging all the kudos.
I thought he was on a diet.
Look, Beverly, if it isn't me, they'll send someone else to inspect the gym.
Well, I'll have to give you a manicure before you go.
Why?
Hygiene regulations. I can't have you poking around my state-of-the-art wellness centre with half a ton of German filth under those nails.
I wasn't intending to touch anything.
Shirl, beauty station number 2, and break out the emergency manicure set.
All right. Ooh. Where is it?
That shoebox under the sink.
Oh.
I'll need 10 cotton swabs. The cuticle pusher. The heavy-duty file and the callus remover.
Is that really necessary, Beverly?
Do I tell you how to do your job, Wendy?
Yes.
All right, sit down. Chill. Chrome forceps.
What?
Pass me the clippers.
Oh, right.
This won't hurt.
Ow!
Well, sit still, you big baby. Just pushing back your cuticles. All right.
Fine. Oof.
Are you sure you're cut out for the police?
It's all I ever wanted, Beverly.
Yeah, but you thought you'd be solving murders and foiling terrorists, and here you are, worried about traffic cones and dog fouling. I'm putting your hands into soap, Wendy.
Oh, this is very hot!
It's supposed to be. Oh, you're too good for all the petty crime, Wendy. You did a degree. Domestic science, wasn't it?
Forensic science, but I dropped out.
What happened?
I met Gordon. He had this mad romantic idea to go globetrotting.
With his feet?
Yeah. We packed up and moved to New Zealand.
Oh, what an adventure.
Not really. We had to come back after a week. Beryl called Gordon from the hospital.
Why?
She had lockjaw.
How did she talk if she had lockjaw?
Well, I bet she was tight-lipped.
Was she all right?
Oh, yeah. Turned out she'd just overdone the polygrip.
You know, if you hadn't let Gordon wrap you round his little finger, turn your head and sweep you off your feet, you could have followed your dream, Wendy.
One of these days, I'm going back to academia.
Where the nuts come from.
What?
Academia nuts. Our Graham loves them.
Right, and now for the nail varnish. Severed artery red to fire you up.
I'm not sure Gordon would approve.
No, he's just jealous. You know, you should go back to New Zealand, Wendy.
Gordon would never leave Beryl.
Well, that's his problem. You owe it to yourself to fulfil your full utensil.
I don't know. Gordon's always been very loyal to me.
Has he? He's forced you to give up university to follow his pipe dream.
But,
Well, he didn't like you wearing nail varnish and he scuppered your promotion to sergeant.
He didn't. He put a good word in for me, Bev.
That's not what he told us, is it, Shirl?
What?
Well, he said he was doing you a favour. He didn't think you were ready.
Why would he do that?
You're younger, brighter. He's always been scared of you showing him up.
You think so?
Life's too short, Wendy. Throw off the shackles of male oppression. As Jerome Greer said, at first you'll be afraid, you'll be petrified, thinking you can't live without Gordon by your side, thinking how he did you wrong, but you'll grow strong.
You will survive.
Don't interrupt, Shirl.
Isn't that Gloria Gaynor?
No, well, she might have put it to music. All I'm saying, in a caring and compassionate way, is that you have to dump Gordon and make a new life for yourself.
I don't think I haven't thought of it, Beverly, but he needs me.
What for? To do the washing up and apply the fungal cream.
Has that still not cleared up?
No.
Your choice, Wendy. Most people end up settling for second best, don't they, Shirl?
If they're lucky.
You're right. I'm going to follow my dream.
Well, the travel agent's open till 6.
What about the police?
Oh, they can get stuffed.
Good for you, Wendy. Well, that's your nails beautiful again. Give me the £30 and you can be on your way.
I suppose I'll still need to inspect the gym.
Well, you don't have to now. That's your old life.
They'll only send someone else. I'll have a quick look and maybe...